All right, very great. The last five videos I've done have all had technical difficulties, and was unable to post any of them. And maybe about 9 hours or more of taping, actually. It's amazing. Just one after the other. Any great content, but what can you do? What can you do? Just keep persevering here. So welcome to the video. We have some very good content to you if I can keep bringing it through and my voice holds up. One of the videos, my voice was just lost my voice. A severe fatigue, strain, etc. We're going through a time of at least I am of great difficulty. Now, I've noticed that right beneath the surface. In sleep, while I'm sleeping, and then half awake, there's this very much enlightened awareness that's present. And it keeps informing me, what needs to be done. And I keep trying, but when you go into wakefulness, waking up, which I call waking sleep, there's three types of sleep: waking sleep, and deep sleep. And then the fourth state is you're actually, it's the only awake state there is. In waking sleep, this is the strongest forgetfulness of what we are. And in this information I got this morning, I was told that what we need to do, I was able to see divinity in everyone in this dreamlike state. And I was told, this is what you need to do. You need to see that everyone has divinity. They're all of divine origin. We're all of divine origin. And we only need to see that just a fraction, like a 1/16th or 1/15th, something like that. Tiny bit. And that's all we need to see. And then that proves to us, aha, we are of divine origin. We're just trying to dissociate from it. And this is all important to see this. And so I said, okay, great. And then I started to go into to wake up into wakeful sleep, waking sleep, waking sleep. And of course, I struggled to bring it through. I tried so hard to bring it through. But what happens when you go into waking sleep? What happens? The beautiful carriage, poof, turns into a pumpkin, right? Turns into a Cinderella's carriage, turns into a pumpkin. And you say, wait a minute, I thought I had this beautiful carriage here. And I saw it as a pumpkin. Oh, but I still have a glass slipper. So something reminds us. And so I remembered, yeah, I remember that. I said, okay, but how do we bring this through into our everyday life where we can actually see divinity? Okay, actually see divinity in everyone. And this brings about what I would say is bliss. It brings about vast reassurance. Incalculable. I don't even try to calculate ahead of time, but I just feel this is the great relief. We realize this is all a masquerade. It's all a masquerade. Everything is fine. Reality is still flawless and perfect. Nobody is in any danger or harm whatsoever. We're all divine, and this just brings about an enormous, enormous relief for us. Because right now we don't see it. Yeah, we don't see it. And so we keep trying to be nice, everybody, but I'm not sure. I can't really tell if you're divine or not. Some seem to be nicer than others, and we just go on that type of judgment and guesswork. And by the way, nice doesn't have anything to do with bliss, and neither does happiness either. In fact, depression and happiness are equally different from bliss. One is not closer to bliss than the other, actually. Apples and oranges. Happiness might be a crisp apple. Depression might be a mushy apple. But bliss is like an orange. Okay. It's apples and oranges. Same thing with being a nice person or a grouchy, person. Neither one is any closer to bliss. So if you're a grouchy, depressed person, which I am most of the time, that's just as close to bliss as being a optimistic, happy, nice person or something. Neither one is any closer to bliss. Bliss is something that comes is factual, where you factually see divinity in everyone, even though it's a tiny, just a glimmer. You can see it. It can't be hidden completely. And how do we recognize this. Now, all perception is actually mental. So it's something in the mind that we're able to do. And I was told in this semi-dream, you know, this is what you need to do. You can do this. And so I'm trying to ask, I'm asking, how do I see this? How does my mind recognize this? And of course, in this world, it seems that the purpose of the world is to make sure we don't recognize it. Make sure we don't recognize it. Now, there's many, many flavors of ignorance here. And ignorance means to ignore. So there's many different ways we ignore recognizing the divinity in all of us. And, you know, one of the ways is a lot of the various religious teachings and beliefs, okay? That's a flavor. But there are other flavors, too, and we don't want to say, well, one's better than the other. They're all ways to ignore. They're all ways to remain ignorant, actually. A lot of religion is very pagan. It's very much ignoring. The term pagan has been used historically to mean those who pay no attention to the true divinity that we all are and pretend that we actually are these bodies, we actually are flesh, we, you know, that we don't have divine origin, truly, truly divine origin, that this isn't just a masquerade, that this is actually reality. This is called the pagan mindset. The mindset of the flesh is often used. And so there are many ways, much of religion is those who practice it are very much pagan, and the religion takes on that, gets tinged with this paganism. And again, that's just one flavor. There's also non-religious pagans, many, and all sorts of ways to remain ignorant. All sorts of ways to remain ignorant. Now, we don't want to remain ignorant, do we? We do not want to remain ignorant. Absolutely not. So, we are working in very urgently, very urgently, to wake up from this ignorance and to bring from this sleeping sleep, to bring from this sleeping sleep into this waking sleep, to bring the recognition of divinity through. And this is, the ones who do this are called the saints, or the enlightened ones. And for them, it's just factual. They see it and they say, well, I'm just, you know, this is a fact for me. I see it. It's not like there's some nice people and I'm a happy, nice saint. No, the saint is way beyond happy and happy niceness. They're relieved. They're relaxed. They're like, well, reassured, like, wow, it's all a masquerade. Okay. Whew, you know, it's kind of like going through some ride at some theme park that's scary and you're up and down and you're, you know, on this roller coaster and you're like, ah, my gosh, I'm just so freaked out, I'm so scared, and then the ride comes to an end and you get out and you go, oh my gosh, I'm off of that ride, you know, isn't that, I'm relieved, that was too scary. The saints are like that. They're off the ride. You know, they see the divinity. It's a fact. It's not just judgment or conjecture, something that they're imagining and they're imagining. No, it's a fact. It's factual. We are all of absolute divine origin. Absolutely, we are all of divine origin, but we have to see that. And in this waking sleep, we don't see it. Now, oftentimes in sleeping sleep, we don't see it. Maybe even deep sleep, we don't see it. But what I've been able to do is bring the truth through into sleeping sleep and close to waking sleep. Now, very close. Last couple months, I've so many dreams of bliss and enlightenment. So it's right beneath the surface. But getting it, you know, through to this waking sleep is the difficulty, and this is what we want to do, and we want as many of us as possible to do this, because there may be some 100th monkey situation where enough of us do this and many will start saying, hey, I can do this too. It's just that when you have a world full of extreme ignorance, you come into this world, you begin to have self-doubts, don't you? And you may come into this world enlightened, actually, aware that you're, that all is divine origin. And actually all is totally divine right now. And the ignorance of the world will begin pushing this back, pushing it away. And what happens is first you'll lose it in your waking sleep. You'll end up being another zombie here. This really is zombie land here. This whole world is a zombie planet, actually. And yeah, spiritual zombie planet actually is. This is zombie land or something, you know. And so what happens, it pushes this awareness into sleeping sleep. and it disappears from your waking sleep condition. And then the further, you know, ignorance of this world pushes it out of sleeping sleep into deep sleep. And then eventually it pushes it out of deep sleep too. So you're just like really a certified zombie here. And in my case, it was very difficult. I resisted having it pushed out of wakeful sleep to a tremendous extent. But finally, when I was about age 12, it got pushed into sleeping sleep entirely. And I lost the, you know, I lost the waking sleep awareness, whatever I had left of it. And so that's when I began to focus on paying attention to my dreams and to my sleep, because that's where I was still, you know, wisdom and awareness there. And so I resisted as best as possible. So it's still there. It's still there just beneath the surface now, actually. And that's why I'm able to do these videos, because I'm able to sit here quietly. I'm sort of able to, it's almost like a semi-sleep, you know, it's a focused semi-sleep condition. I'm not out there I'm not actually, you know, doing all sorts of stuff that would distract and bring ignorance to me. I'm able to focus enough so I can bring some of it through, but it needs to come through and surface here in wakeful sleep. And how to do that is very pertinent for me, and I know for some others too. Obviously, there's some others watching these videos who their sleeping sleep is there's tremendous enlightenment there, you know, and they get in touch with it. They're getting in touch with it, and they realize it's just beneath the surface, just beneath the surface. But bringing it into this world of, you know, zombie land has been a tremendous struggle for me. I guess very frustrating, to say the least. Now, I have been using the great assertion, I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. For instance, yesterday I used it all day, repetitive, during everything I was doing. I kept repeating. I did a tremendous job on this, and I finally was so, I'm so nervous and stressed out and stuff, because I know this is right beneath the surface. There's a big struggle going on. Towards the end of the day, in the late evening, I finally said, oh man, I could just listen to a song. So I listened to the song, and of course that led to another and another and another and another, and before you know it, I was, you know, I'd really deteriorated, and then it busted my momentum up, and then today I've had to try to reestablish that momentum. So it, you know, it gets to us, and but that great assertion, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I believe this is the diamond drill, the Vajra drill, the diamond drill, which drills through this resistance, drills through from sleeping sleep into waking sleep, okay, which is our day-to-day functioning, which is the deepest level of forgetfulness there is. No question about it. We're really stupid as in our wakeful sleepness. We are truly, forgetful zombies of forgetfulness, believing that there's nothing to remember. We're so forgetful, we don't even realize there's something to remember. See, where in my case, I knew I'd forgotten something, because I kept it for so long. I was absolutely certain that I had forgotten something extremely important. And so there was no stop. I immediately went into intense spiritual quest from early age, actually. But you can say from the age of 12, which would be 1968, I would say. I was in an intense spiritual quest since that time, since I was 12. So that would be, 46 years, actually, of extremely intense spiritual search. Because I knew I had forgotten something that was of ultimate importance. Whereas others, they don't, you know, it gets pushed away from them so easily that it never occurs to them that they forgot anything of extreme importance. So their lives seem to be somewhat trouble-free. It's like, I haven't forgotten anything. Everything's fine. I'm a body. I'm going to die, and that's it. Their life seems easy for them. But for me, life has been terrible, because I know there's something of absolute vital importance I have to remember, and I can't seem to bring it through into waking sleep. It's there in sleeping sleep. It's absolutely there. And but you know, what good is that there? It needs to come through to waking sleep. So this is the interesting predicament, and I know I'm most certainly not alone. Most certainly not alone. There are many of us like this, that we know it's just beneath the surface, you know, and it's like waking sleep is like the tip of an iceberg, and many people in this world believe that that's all there is to the iceberg. There's nothing else. There's nothing else there. And when that melts, when that tip of the iceberg melts beneath the ocean, you know, that's it. It's not the perfect analogy, right? Because if it melts, the iceberg would more would float up. But when that's gone, you know, people say, okay, that's it. It's all over. Finished. That's it. I lived a happy life, and that's it. But actually, beneath the surface, there's this incredibly massive iceberg, you know. It just goes on and on and on and on forever. And so those who are aware of that say, hey, I'm not just this little surface persona in waking sleep. That's not all that I am. This at all. I'm the totality of the iceberg, so to speak. I am the totality. I am of divine origin. I am divine origin. Absolutely, everyone is. And what we want to see is that everyone is. This brings the reassurance, because by not seeing that, we're not seers. We're not seeing what is a fact. Not seeing the facts, actually, of our being. And when you not see facts, what do you? You're a not seer. You're a not seer. You might even shorten and say you're a Nazi. So this world is full of Nazi zombies, actually. If you want to be factual, that's what the world's full of, is Nazi zombies. And they're running things here. And they're setting up their little hive here, which reinforces the belief, their beliefs, that this is it. That the waking sleepfulness is our true condition. It's our real condition. Everything else is a false fantasy, is forgetfulness. And they think if we don't dare forget this waking zombiness, waking sleepness, don't dare forget that. That's our reality. And if we bring through this other realization of enlightenment, they say, well, we'll forget our identity. You know, that's horrible. It's terrible. We'll forget all about it. We'll forget all about what we are. So they have another. They have it backwards, upside down, and backwards, and it makes this world. It makes it very difficult for us. Anyone trying to bring it through, people are having troubles. We're having troubles here. I mean, I'm embarrassed that I've had such trouble. It's shameful, but it's happened, and I think I should have been able to do this long ago, but have not been able to yet. So. Have to keep trying. And what better place to be under pressure than in California? What better place right now in the world to be? Because we've got one year of rain, water left. We have 1 year of water left. That's what NASA has now said, this after studying the situation. 1 year. So a year from now, basically, if it doesn't rain anymore, we'll be out of water. And this is why I say June 21st to 16. It's time of great intensity in this world, right? Time of great intensity in the globe, and we want to be awake by then. So we feel the pressure here. We feel we're under the gun. Got to get something done. It's good to be under pressure. This is how I feel. Remember that happiness of the flesh and sadness of the flesh are equidistant from bliss, spiritual bliss, actually, which is based on factual seeing the facts. So being under pressure, being miserable and stuff, I don't mind. I don't mind so much being, I've been miserable my whole life. I don't feel I'm missing anything that important at all. You look at happy people, and I realize that there's no real difference at all. It's totally superficial anyway. And I see all sorts of wealthy people happy. It doesn't matter if you're poor, if you're suffering, you're miserable in this world, that's okay. That's absolutely okay. Don't worry about it, because again, it's apples and oranges when it comes to bliss. In no way are you farther away from bliss. If you're some poor, suffering, miserable person, you're no farther away from bliss than some rich, super rich, happy, confident, you know, optimistic person. In no way are you any farther away. And your transition to bliss is the same as anyone's transition, which is totally smooth and almost virtually imperceptible. The ego wants it to be some massive event where you go tear your clothes off and run around screaming, hugging everybody, and causing a huge ruckus and disturbing the world and everything, you know, rocking the boat, and because it can then proscribe against that. But actually, it's I believe, in my couple of experiences I've had, it's super smooth. It's like the smoothest transmission, automatic transmission shift. It's just like automatic transmission. You don't even realize the car shifted, right? And you're just in a different gear, just like that. It's like, oh, I'm in a different gear. So think about automatic transmission in a real quiet, smooth car. You're driving along, and then you just feel like, oh, you know, I'm in a different gear now. That's it. It's that, you know, smooth. Nothing bad the ego can say about that, right? Not at all. So this is what we want, and we need to determine how do we get this, what's just beneath the surface, to surface and stay surface, so it doesn't just pop up and then go back underneath like a whale getting some air or something, or a dolphin jumping out and then goes back underneath. We want the fish to jump out of the water and have wings, you know, and just sail and stay airborne, as it were. Keep flying. Now again, the secret to this is that you're actually seeing facts. You're actually seeing facts. So how can you not fly under those circumstances? You're no longer judging. You're no longer thinking. You're no longer trying to determine. You now, your mind actually sees the divinity. It recognizes as, oh, this is factual now. And so how difficult is it then? It's not that difficult at all anymore, is it? We're not trying to judge every person, because we plainly see the fractional, you know, appearance of divinity in everybody. It's right there to see. And so we say, oh, you know, you're not fooling me one bit. Nobody's fooling me at all anymore. And the way that people freak us out is to say that we can't see the divinity in them. And that does freak us out. Absolutely, it freaks us out. We say, oh, what happened? You managed to separate? Well, if you could separate, that means I could be separate too. That means something I need to guard against. So I'm now fearful. And how did you separate? You know, and on and on. But if you see, nobody is separated. It's like, oh, I can't separate either. I don't need to worry about it. I don't need to worry about that at all anymore. And so life, the situation here becomes one of great ease and lack of concern or worry anymore. And it's all factually based on what you're directly seeing. So it's a piece of cake to keep it when we see it that way. So we are doing our very best to thin out this resistance so we can allow this to surface here in the waking sleep. And certainly those who realize that this enlightenment is just beneath the surface, when someone allows this to arise in waking sleep, of course they're going to pay attention, of course. And because they're going to say, wow, it is doable. This is important. This is important to me. So this is why, of course, we seek out the teachers, right? Those who have this situation, you know, they're always seeking, you know, maybe this book, maybe this teacher, maybe this, maybe that. I got to, you know, get this done. And that's what it's all about. So yeah, of course you're going to draw attention. You know, people say, "Wow, well, you know, that's part of the resistance. You know, it comes with the territory." I get a little nervous about that. You know, because people are desperate. You know, we're desperate. We say, "I just can't seem to, you know, do this." And We have to discipline ourselves. We have to, as we go along, we have to pick up good habits and drop bad habits along the way. This is very important. Pagans don't care about bad habits. For them, there's nothing to remember. There's nothing that needs to surface. This is just, they think the flesh, waking sleep is reality. The flesh is real. They say, okay, indulge the flesh and do whatever you want to do. Have, you know, feels good, do it. Have a great time. Come on. And of course, so, you know, that's not an issue. It's not an issue. Bad habits for them, not an issue. They say, well, it doesn't matter. Once I die, that's it, and et cetera, which is simply not true. But for those who are remembered, there's something I forgot that's so important. You have to pick up good habits and drop the bad ones as much as possible as you go along, and get better and better and better at it. This is the testimony of those who have succeeded. And there are those who have succeeded. Absolutely, throughout history, there are those who have succeeded at this, and they tell us, you know, it's not so easy. It's they struggle with it, and they say you're likely to struggle with it too. And I can testify, I've certainly struggled with it. It's ridiculous, but somehow the resistance is quite potent and quite tricky. And so we need to keep working at it, which is what we are doing here. And I believe that this, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me, is a very, very potent way to succeed at this. So I'm continuing to do this, and when something arises, I try to squelch it, a train of thought. I'll say, no matter what it is, positive, negative, hopeful, optimistic, just go right back. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Make sure that this is capturing. Oh, it is. Wonderful. As I've said, I've lost a tremendous amount of programming here on this channel through technical difficulties, but hopefully this one will work. And so I feel a little more confidence speaking. When you feel that you're going to lose your taping, it's really difficult to give it everything you've got, because in the back of your mind saying, uh-oh, I think I might lose this one, and so why should I really put, you know, 100% effort into it? Yeah. So just beneath the surface, we must remember this. This is true. Do not doubt the inner guru, the inner wisdom. It's right there. For some of us, we've brought it through, so it's just right there beneath the surface, confirmed by dreams and by moments of, you know, breaks through at certain moments, and we become aware and say, wow, just right there. It's so close, you know, it's like just not, you know, it's almost like another dimension. It's, you know, it's right there, but it seems I just can't somehow bring it through. It's just so frustrating. The difference between sleeping sleep and waking sleep, you know, is it's so subtle in many ways. But I have confidence that, you know, I will succeed. We will succeed. Somehow we will get the ball rolling here. And we need to. There is no time to waste. Crises are coming in the world. Drought is a crisis, believe me. You know how most foods were discovered? I often wonder how so many, many odd foods in the world, right? And I always think, who in the world ever thought of eating that and discovering this food? This is just was incredible. The human, you know, I say human ingenuity, I can't understand it. But this afternoon I suddenly said, hey, wait a minute. What if a lot of discoveries happened during severe famine? Historically, and actually historically, famine has been a terrible scourge throughout history, an awful, awful scourge throughout history. And when you are experiencing famine, you're going to try and eat it whatever you can get your hands on. And so if you see some stuff in the ground growing, you know, you're going to pull it up and try to eat it. See, maybe this, you know, is edible. Now, maybe it makes you sick and you die, but in a famine there might be millions of people, and maybe after all these people, maybe they'll find something that they can eat that's edible, like mushrooms or fungus or, you know, what, slugs, who knows what, whatever they can get their hands on. I mean, in famines, people eat anything. They eat bark off trees, they eat dirt, literally. This is no joke. I mean, we had a famine not so long ago, in the Ukraine, actually, right? After World War II, it was before World War II, during the Stalinization period, I believe, or something like that. Yeah, terrible famine, on purpose. People were eating dirt, and you're just desperate. You'll eat anything, and so those who find something that works, they say, hey, you can eat this, you know, and actually it helps save our lives, and then it enters the human, you know, human diet as something that's an edible plant. But I, you know, I look at all these plants and weeds and stuff, I say, I wonder if I could eat that weed or something. I say, well, I better not try. But if you were starving, you would try. And of course, there's the great Bengali famine in the World War II. That may have been the one of the last famines, and the, you know, various typhoons, like in Africa, Bangladesh. It keeps going on and on, and we're approaching a crisis situation in California for sure. Today is another gorgeous summer day. You know, every day is a gorgeous summer day, it seems like. So the world is in crisis. We know that. As it's said in various prophecies, that the there'll be a time when the world, you can tell, there's just all this, you know, basically it says climate change, really. A lot of floods, a lot of famines, a lot of droughts, a lot of fires, earthquakes. You know, it'll be a time when the globe just seems to be inundated with tension, with global climate change, political tensions and everything like this. And there's a lot of indication that we're in such a time. And if you add up also the idea of a global antichrist grabbing hold of the planet, so to speak, that all the technology we have, all this leads one to believe that we're in the end of the cycle that's been talked about. And so the heat is on us. The heat is on us. Two, break that, not break the barrier, but to evaporate the barrier between the states of consciousness, between the fourth state of awakeness, deep sleep, sleeping sleep, and waking sleep. All that becomes one. All that becomes just one state, so to speak. It's permeated with truth. And when anyone has done this, then others who want to do it, obviously they're going to have very keen interest. Very keen interest. And why not? Of course they will. And it may be frustrating. It is frustrating. It is, because you see someone else do it and yet you can't do it. You say, I don't understand. Why can't I do it? So it can be a frustrating situation, for sure. For sure, you think, oh, what's wrong? The teacher, obviously, they've done it, and no matter what I do, I can't do it. And so, again, I say, pick up good habits along the way. Let go of your bad habits, and just keep doing that. Keep doing that. My best information is that you simply need to wear it away. You need to evaporate it away. You need to go at it as best you can, and continue to try better, you know, more and more and more, like yesterday, constantly. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. And just kept doing that all day, just relentlessly. So that shows you, you know, that you can up the amount of work that you do, which is what I've been doing. I'm having to increase it because I'm getting more desperate. Just like in a drought, you have to decrease the water you use, right? And so we are already there with that. Here, That's a situation of decreasing the water you use, being more careful. Here, we need to increase the efforts we are using to drill through this barrier of forgetfulness, of ignorance, of ignoring. This barrier of ignoring that is taken as normal, which means you're normally adjusted to this world. You're normally adjusted. Who wants to be normally adjusted to forgetfulness? Who wants to be normally adjusted to forgetfulness of what we truly are? One has forgotten what they are. Is it a good thing to be normally adjusted to that? Why would anyone want to be normally adjusted to that? One should not be normally adjusted to that, which is why I've suffered depression and anxiety and all these things, because I don't want to adjust to it. I don't want to adjust to forgetfulness of what I am. And so I paid the price of suffering and misery trying to say, no, I want to remember, I don't want to be just as, I don't want to be zombified here. And, you know, in zombie movies, if they get you, you know, you turn into a zombie. This is the world. The world is a zombie planet. And they go out, the zombies go after you. And if they get you, they're going to drive that truth of being deeper into, you know, sleep, and deeper into deep sleep, like that. And you become functionally another zombie. You become infectious. You carry the disease. We don't want to do that. So the pressure here is almost more than I can hardly bear. I'm very tired all the time. Very intense. Woke up at 4 o'clock this morning and working on it. And then had to work real hard carrying heavy loads today, and but still working on it here. Still working on it. And what else can we do? We're in a drastic crisis in California, actually. It's creeping up like a snake on us, you know. I've been aware it's coming for quite some time. In fact, I was born with the awareness that there's going to be eventual problems here. And I've known there's going to be a crisis in this state, in this world. So that's why I'm working just nonstop. I don't just take it easy and say, oh yeah, everything's fine, no worries here. You know, no, everything is not fine here. Look at the history of this planet. And so many disasters snuck up on civilizations. Right? Snuck up on them. Well, you know, we're in one right now here in the West. Is just this denial. We think, oh, you know, no, nothing bad can happen here. We're immune to now. We're immune to it. We're immune to it. And I don't think people are ready to realize that they're not immune. This is part and parcel of their identity is being a Californian. You think that you found the good life, finally. And to realize that not only have you not found the good life, we're in like a catastrophe coming upon us. I don't think anyone's here is ready for that. Their psyche is simply not ready for it. The good life, the real, so what do we have to do? We have to find the true good life, the real good life, all right? Which is to factually see the divinity of everyone, that we're all of divine origin, all of us. All is of divine origin, in spite of all our attempts to camouflage this. That's the good news. And I believe that this will fundamentally give us a new outlook that we can rely upon, and one that will never suffer drought. This outlook will certainly never suffer any misfortune or drought at all. Once we're able to get this into the waking sleep. So it's worth giving everything you've got. It absolutely is worth it, and I continue to do that. I continue to use this diamond drill technique of I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And just repeat, and just keep drilling. And then in the future, we'll cross those bridges when we get to it. But most certainly, some want to wake up, and others want to concoct a new form of ignorance, a new way to ignore the truth, thinking that, you know, they can use you as a figurehead to do this, because they think that no, that this information is supposed to be somewhere else, it's not supposed to be in waking, but so they have to kind of learn how to propitiate it, you know, and say don't break through into waking sleep here, we don't want you, but we, if we'll worship you and tell you how wonderful you are, then you agree to stay away, you know. And it's very much like that, you know. So that, of course, has to be weeded out. You don't want those weeds in the garden. If you're growing tomato plants, you know, there's some clever weeds that jump in there. I've often been struck by how clever weeds are, you know, and how they can masquerade, have a similar look to a plant that we don't call a weed, and how they're able to grow, intertwine, and grow the way. I said, what? You know, weeds seem very intelligent, actually, very clever. And how did they happen to pick right next to this plant? How did they get there? I know the wind's supposed to blow the seeds around, but I said, you know, there's something very odd with weeds, how they're expert at camouflaging, so you tend to overlook them. And then later on, you go, how did that weed get in my garden? You know, they're very clever and successful that way. There's maybe more to weeds than meets the eye. And the same thing in this world, that there are those who are so frightened of this, of realization breaking through into waking sleep. They don't want it at all costs. They want to keep it out. But when they realize it can happen, they say, well, wait a minute, you know, what price do we need to pay to keep you, you know, keep it out of here? And they're willing to, you know, idolize you in order to, they think, you know, keep it out. That's the, you know, that's the deal, you know, the deal that they make. So there's that, and there's all sorts of, you know, variations in this situation. But the bottom line is, there are those who really want to get it done, and so they're interested, of course, genuinely interested. As I have been genuinely interested in those who have done it. And so, you know, that attention, that interest, that attention certainly exists in the world. And what I say is that it's the enlightened state is actually just a factual state where you literally see the facts. And so it's easy to stay there, actually. It's not difficult at all. In fact, what's difficult is to not stay there. That's what's actually difficult. And that's what the ego's very frightened of. You know, it wants to believe that it's very difficult to stay there. So it'll praise you and say, wow, it's incredible. How did you do this? It's so difficult and all this stuff. It's a lie. It's a lie. It's not difficult to stay there. It should not be the slightest bit difficult, because you're literally seeing the facts that all are of divine origin. All are divine origin, and it's literally seen. You're recognized. It's recognized, clearly recognized. So then you don't have to do anything about establishing it or keeping it that way or anything like that. Piece of cake, absolute piece of cake. Again, it's the forgetfulness that's difficult. That's the forgetfulness that is very, very difficult. And many ask, well, how can I stay enlightened without being able to see the facts, There's no way, of course. There's no way. See, the ego tells us that we're smart if we can still believe something even though we don't see the facts. Say, oh yeah, that's even higher condition, that you're, even though you don't see the facts, you just have so much faith that you can... No, that's really stupid. Because then you're easily pushed away from truth. And that's, but if you literally see the truth, it's obvious right in front of your face, right, you know, you can't miss it. Then what's the big deal? See, of course. It's not... It's no trouble at all. No trouble at all. And the ego doesn't like that. It wants it to be very much troublesome. So it wants to mix the state of forgetfulness in with the state of remembrance to make sure that you'll forget the state of remembrance, or you can easily forget it. And so we have this sort of egoic state that is, you know, between sleeping sleep and waking sleep, where it's a mixture. And so you get the truth and then you forget it. You get the truth and you forget it. Get the truth and you forget it. Like that. So we have to go past that state where we're getting, I call it the dawn state. It's the dawn. There's this dawn state where like, you know, you're in half sleep almost, and you get all this wisdom and clarity, and you see it, and you know, yeah, I know exactly what to do. And then you go into full waking sleep, and then you can, you know, completely forget it. So we don't want to get stuck in the dawn. We don't want to get stuck in the dawn. We want to go into the fullness of the day. Fullness of the day. This is our aim. Maybe we're experiencing spring fever here, tiredness, because the climate is so different than what our historic expectations are. I believe it's having an effect. It really is. I feel sleepy. Something in us is telling us, hey, this isn't right for March, 18 or 19, 18, this just isn't right, this can't be March 18th. I remember like a couple years ago, I planted a vegetable garden on this date, or I believe it was around this date, and it had just, on this very day, it had started to warm up, okay, so I put it on that very day it started warming up, and it stayed warm the whole rest of the spring, so I had a very early garden, tremendous garden. I got it in as early as possible. Well, you know what? This year, you could have planted a month ago, or you know, early February, and be okay. It simply has been warm. The entire January, February, March, it's been warm. So you could have planted super early this year and been okay. So this warmth today is in 2 years' time, it has changed drastically, actually. And we thought back 2 years ago that being warm this early was quite unusual, and it just stayed warm. Well, it's now gone way past that. Hottest year on record in California last year, hottest winter on record this year. And so we may just be suffering. I may be suffering partly from that, and also from tremendous strain and stress in many ways. Wanting to get the job done, running into these resistances, and having to be patient, and say, "Hey, wait! I've been patient my whole life, and I still can't get it." And that's difficult. You feel like maybe you're stupid. You know, how come I can't do it? So again, the answer is to see, for the mind to see the divinity. Okay, let's just get very clear and focus in. What is the ultimate solution? It's for the mind to see divinity, and to bring this seeing into the waking sleep state. or to be more precise, maybe, as it's brought into the waking sleep state, the waking sleep state itself becomes transformed into something else. And as such, maybe you don't need the sleep state either. That becomes transformed too. There's no longer this tension between the two. There's no longer the psychic tension going on. That's what we say, that those who have done this, they say that the waking sleep and sleeping sleep are the same to them. And even the deep sleep, it's all the same. That's not surprising. It's not surprising at all. So let us continue to focus in on how to get this done. What is it that we can do, and what are the resistances? What do we need to look at? And it's interesting, as we try to pull this into waking sleep, there's a strong pull to go into sleeping sleep, where where the waking sleep tries to play possum, and so it cannot get anything, because you fall asleep. And so this is partly what I'm experiencing, is that there's a very strong push to play possum. Part of the success, I believe, that will come is just this overall focusing on it and looking at it directly like this, and talking about it and bringing it up and trying to normalize it in our consciousness, in our expectations, in our familiarity, in our expectations, which really are the cross that we carry in this world. We all carry this cross, which is the cross of familiarity and expectations, which lag behind our adventurousness and our desire for quick results, because they say, hey, wait a minute, I'm not familiar with that, or hey, wait a minute, that's not what I expected. And they're like two passengers in our car, and and we're the ones that are accelerating, hitting the accelerator, and then the passengers start complaining, saying, this is going too fast. I'm not used to this territory we're going into. I'm not used to going past it, so fast. Slow down, slow down, slow down. And then you hit the brake, you slow down. So we're carrying these passengers in our vehicle of the spiritual path, and we need to be sensitive to them, so they don't cause too much trouble for us. We don't want to ignore them entirely. We don't want to drug them. We don't want to, because they can really cause problems for us. This inner fear of continuity, this inner continuity fear, based on familiarity and expectation. Expectation means what? How do we expect our life to go? Right? How do we expect our life? We all have expectations, and the expectations are passed down to us from generation after generation. We have a whole, ancestrally, going all the way back, is all these expectations of what does it mean to be here in this world? What does it mean to be a human in this world? And so this is a huge barrier to realization, because for most of us, nobody expects us to bring this through into waking sleep. In fact, most here are completely ignorant that there is such a possibility. doesn't even exist. They have no, so these expectations are that you won't do it, of course. And so we have to struggle with this expectation that I'm not going to do that. That's not how my life is going to go. And then when you start almost doing it, you say, wow, my life's going to change. But it's really that we just have this crazy expectations that we're going to fail. And you say, that's how my life is going to go. It's going to be a failure. And people are so comfortable with failure here, failure to do this. They're so comfortable with it. They just, the skids are all greased for failure here. And everybody pats you on the back and reassures you and says, don't worry, you know, we'll make a nice gravestone for you. You won't be forgotten. As you slip into sleep, and then, you know, deep sleep, and then some maybe brief glimpse of awakeness, and then habits pull us back into, you know, back towards sleep, deep sleep, and ultimately waking sleep. That's the being reborn, and as a baby, you're engaged in a lot of deep sleep and sleeping sleep, and not too much waking sleep. And then as you get older, the ratio changes. And we are told that the sign of maturity and growth in any person is to reach the waking state, the waking sleep state. We're told that that's the goal. That's called maturity. That's called growing up, as you become accustomed to accepting waking sleep state, the waking sleep. So we're enculturated for this goal. We're absolutely enculturated for this here. And we're bribed, you know, with all these material goods. The corporations bribe us, really. They're saying, hey, you know, just stay in this waking sleep state. It's good for us. It's good for you. It's good for everybody. And you deserve a break today. Speaking of that, you deserve a break today. That was the old McDonald's commercial. You deserve a break today, so get up and go away to McDonald's. Ron Hicklin singers. They did that, the commercial, along with tons of other commercials, famous commercials, during the great age of optimism here in America, where, you know, it was just wow, materiality was pouring through. We had all these fast food places now, and life was becoming space age, and we felt like, you know, we're gonna really find happiness here. Speaking of the Ron Hicklin or Hinklin singers, they did an enormous number of backups. There was a huge recording industry, for instance, in Los Angeles. And this is something that really impacted my life, because my previous life was a very 100% involved as a musician. And music was for me all there was of value in the world. That's it. Nothing else had any value. But music held ultimate value for me. So I came into this world, and I wanted to increase the value of the world for everybody by producing, you know, great music here. And so I grew up listening to music constantly. It was in the house, always, and I was always listening to it. And I was listening and trying to figure out, okay, you know, what are people listening to? What are the sounds I'm hearing? How can I put those all together, make something even better? You know, how can I make it better? How can I increase the beauty of music in this world? That was my personality goal, as it were. Or spiritual goal I had was, how do I get enlightened, actually? Because I knew this is my last life. And but the personality goal was how to make the best music possible. And when we were going into the 60s, what happened with the Beatles, they played their own instruments, okay. And so we got hip to music, the Beatles and the Rolling Stones, and you know, they were playing their own instruments. And actually, they're some of the first you know, super popular bands to do that. But we didn't know that, really. Actually, you know, if you're young enough, you didn't know. Beatles came out in 64. I was like about 8 years old. And of course, the Beach Boys came out in 63, I think, 63, before the Beatles, actually. And they were the, you know, big in California and around the world, but they were huge. And I didn't know that. I thought they played their own instruments. You see them, you know, you saw them in commercials, or if we didn't have a TV, but you watch at a friend's house, you know, in the Tammy show or something, there's the Beach Boys play, and you think they're playing their own instruments, right? And you say, wow. So there's all this music on the radio, and I thought that everyone's playing their own instruments, and we, so if we just buy these instruments, you know, so I bought a guitar, and then I got an electric guitar, I got an amplifier. I said, well, I got to learn how to play this music. They can do it. So if they can do it, I can do it too, for sure. I was sure of it. And so I started practicing, and I sounded terrible. And I tried to figure out, how can I make the music sound as good as what you hear on the radio? And it became an obsession with me, because I couldn't figure it out. And I truly was devastated, because I couldn't do it. And it really, in many ways, ruined my life, because I had so much pride in my musicality, and I failed, and I ended up spending my life, all my effort and money and everything, in trying to figure out how to get this great sound. And I thought it's just a matter of, there's something wrong with me. Why? Well, later on, recently, you know, I've been digging into this for a long time, and putting it together. And I finally have put it together and know what happened. And it was really the most incredible deceit that took place, that really harmed my life and put me through hell of frustration and misery. And if I had have known this, you know, it might have been quite different. But this is what the corporations do, the slick people behind the scenes. The what really happened back then in the late 50s and the 60s and going into the 70s, etc., where people really did start playing their instruments more and more and more. The Beatles sort of started the trend, right? And we had all these garage bands, and everybody thought, hey, we can do it too. But the really slick sounding stuff, okay, there's a reason that music sounded so good as it did back then, and it sounded great, I'm telling you. The music back then was just mind-blowing, really. And the reason is they had the best musicians in the world as session musicians in Los Angeles. They called it the Wrecking Crew, okay, basically. These people were geniuses, okay? These were genius musicians who had a tremendous knack to play tastefully, tasteful music. And they had all these studio musicians on call. I think it was a Western recording studios was one, and then of course, and then the recording studio, was it Columbia or somebody? Anyway, they had these really, really good recording studios that somehow acoustically they got it just right, and they had some genius there too. They had genius producers. Remember, Hollywood was been there for a long time, and so you had these very sophisticated, genius, technical people, producers, arrangers, all of that, and you had these absolute genius musicians able to play any instrument, and they had, you know, different ones be able to play different instruments, but you know, the number of instruments they used was tremendous. Then you had the large diaphragm tube microphones like the Neumann and various things back then. And you had these with great vacuum tubes back then. The vacuum tubes of that time were the best ever. And then you had these recording, the consoles, the mixing consoles were also tube. Everything was tube and what, inch and a quarter, inch and a half magnetic tape. Okay, the tape recording, the way it was done. The reverb chambers that they used back then, you know, were a little bit over the top, but we didn't, I didn't know there was anything such as reverb, for instance. Had no idea of any of this stuff. I just thought they just had a great voice. I played the instruments in a great way. I didn't understand how the producers altered the sound electronically and in the reverb chambers and everything like this. And the wrecking crew who played on these songs, who played on thousands and thousands of songs, commercials also, and then the background singers like the Ron Hicklin or Hicklin singers, they actually sang a lot of harmony on a lot of these songs. The musicians that we saw were front people. They were front people. Like, for instance, the Monkees, okay. They had studio musicians playing their stuff. The Partridge Family, the Ron Hicklin singers, actually did all the singing on the Partridge Family. But we're being told that here's this family of singers, that all you got to do is get together and sing, and this is how you sound. And it fooled us all. And for most people, it's no big deal because they said, "Oh, it just sounds great." But for me, my purpose was to do better than this, and so I wanted to get, you know, people singing together, family singing. I got instruments. Come on, everybody, look, the, you know, the Partridge Family can do it. So can we, kind of thing. And yeah, it's easy. We can do it. And I felt I was capable of doing it. I didn't understand the sophistication behind the scenes, and they didn't give credit to these people. They said, "Oh no, this is the work of, you know, the Yardbirds or the, you know, Sonny and Cher and the Monkees and the Beach Boys and whatever, on and on and on and on and on. Herb Alpert and the Tijuana Brass doing this great sound, you know." It was all the super genius slick production people and these incredible studio musicians, like, you know, that Hal Blaine was the drummer. It was just like incredibly tasteful drummer. You had Carol Kay on the bass on a lot of that, and you know, Leon Russell on keyboards, and Glenn Campbell on guitar, and on and on and on. These people were, you know, tremendously talented, and so the background music that they produced with all these large, you know, diaphragm microphones going, you know, tube microphones going into tube mixing consoles with this tweak just the right way, and then reverb on and on and on, and beautiful tape and onto vinyl. It just produced this incredible sound. And so I always felt completely inadequate, that I couldn't get this sound. And I kept buying new guitars. I kept practicing 8 hours a day, 10 hours a day. And it sounded like terrible, sounded like mud. And I just became freaked out, and I said, you know, got super depressed over that, and said, "I'm really a lousy musician. There's something wrong with me." I said, that's not right. I was the previous life, I was a super virtuoso, but I said, "No, I'm terrible. What happened to me?" I did not know any of this stuff. So I'd listen to the song over and over and over and over and over, saying, "How can I get this sound?" Well, I mean, the Ron Hicklin, or Hicklin singers, I think it's something like that, Ron Hicklin singers. I had never even heard of them up until about a month ago. I never even knew they existed. But they're the ones that did all these incredible commercials for all these products that we thought were fabulous in this time, where there's this beautiful music for the commercials and everything. They never were credited with all the background singing. No, they were like invisible. I didn't even know they existed. And in fact, they even sang for the Anita Kerr Singers, who was another background group that did background singing. They even sang background for the Anita Kerr Singers, you know. And then, of course, in Nashville, there's a Nashville Edition background singers who did a ton of background singing along with the Jordanaires that made those records seem incredibly beautiful and good, which Nashville's another story. They had the A-team, you know, in Nashville, of also great, you know, country players. Same deal. They played on all the songs. Same people, same background singers, Jordan Ayers, Nashville Edition. And it made these songs sound so super, super, super talented. The people played on there were the best in the world. Singers were incredibly tasteful singers. And the stars were just front people. They were just front people. And a lot of them didn't have the greatest voice or anything, but they were personalities. They were entertainers, okay? But the music that you're hearing is not the result of their talents, okay? You know, you could put me or you in that recording studio with all those engineers, the technical equipment they had, and the wrecking crew playing, and we could knock out something mighty sweet, I'm telling you. There's no doubt about it. I'm very confident I could do that without any problem whatsoever. Man, they can make, you know, like for the Mamas and Papas, studio musicians. Okay, I used to love the Mamas and Papas. I said, how do they get that sound, you know? It's incredible. What in the world? It's just beautiful songs. Wrecking Crew, you know, they would, you know, arrange all the music and everything. I mean, what you get the Mamas and Papas, they might write the lyrics, okay? And they practice some harmonies. You get Mama Cass and Michelle Phillips. And Michelle Phillips couldn't really sing hardly at all. You know, I mean, anyone takes someone off the street, they can sing as well as Michelle Phillips. But she was sort of this Nordic, you know, beauty or something. Ideal of glamorous California model, you know, selling, you know, the material society. And so she looked the part and she, you know, could sing, so-so. And then you get the lead guy, the Phillips, the lead guy, and then McKenzie, what was his name, Denny or Denny something, who could sing really well. And so he had two good singers, and the other two were not so good. But they arranged it, and the expert arrangers there, who expert producers and arrangers, along with the recording and the Wrecking Crew, you know, they were able to get the Mamas and Papas to sound absolutely fabulous. And I just listened to it last night. I said, holy cow. And I thought it was just, hey, you can just form a band with anybody. Grab four people. Let's get the electric guitar, some microphones, and a tape recorder. And we should be able to sound just as good, you know, just as good, really. So I got these crummy tape recorders that, you know, that were, and I had many different tape recorders, and it just sounded horrible. It sounded horrible. We didn't even understand multi-tracking. Didn't understand how they multi-track. We thought they just did it live. You know, Brian Wilson, you know, sort of pioneered a lot of that really sophisticated multi-tracking. There was only a few tracks back that time, but they did all sorts of techniques to make it sound incredibly wonderful. And the tape was real wide and got a lot of the rich, you know, the rich sound on it. So here I am with a little cassette deck, plugging some cheap microphones in, trying to, you know, play electric guitars with these crummy amplifiers in, and thinking that somehow I'm supposed to get, somehow there's something wrong with me because I'm not producing the right sound. And so I've lived with this my whole life, thinking that, and it's only recently that I finally, you know, trying to put the whole thing together, you know, traumatized me. And so I am very upset about that we were duped so severely, that you know, corporate, big corporations, big business, it's all about selling an atmosphere, selling a mood, selling us on being zombies, selling us on being zombie consumers, selling us on forgetting our divine nature. And they use these personalities, you know, to sell us on it. They use these personalities to sell it. And so they will build these personalities up in it whichever way they can, whichever way they can. You know, George Jones is out on the road. He's getting, he's as drunk as a skunk every day. And they grab him and say, hey, George, we need a song. And they pull all the studio musicians, the Jordanaires. They have all the tracks already done. This beautiful song waiting for him. And someone else wrote the whole thing. Says, hey, just come in here and sing this song, you know. So they finally get him sober enough to sing the song. It, like, and take him, you know, like a half an hour or something. Boom, you know, finished. Or whatever. And he disappear again for a couple months. And, you know, there's the song on the radio, and you listen, you say, oh my God, that sounds fabulous. You know, look, this is great. You know, what is this? This is wonderful. And it's the Wizard of Oz. It's the Wizard of Oz. And being a musician, this drastically affected my life. Wasted my life chasing after, thinking that if I just practiced a little more, I'd have a breakthrough, and I could sound that way. And of course, that never happened, even remotely. I did my very best, even to the point of building a recording studio, getting the best instruments and microphones, you know, just and then digital came out, and tried to capture that sound they had, but nobody can capture that sound these days. You listen to music these days, they cannot capture that sound of the 60s. I listen to music now, and you listen to SoundCloud, whatever, and it's just terrible. I mean, what is there to listen to, actually? Compare it to back then, and you know, Phil Spector's Wall of Sound, you know, that was, you know, Ronettes, Walking in the Rain, Be My Baby, you know, Righteous Brothers, all this, you know, it's just like massive, you know, sound. It just is like, what is this, some other dimension? And then the Beach Boys with their, you know, incredible harmonies, and then this all worked itself into commercials, jingles on radio stations, TV stations. All these jingles were made by these various Ron Hicklin singers did it, you know, thousands of jingles, I think, and they shipped them out to all these radio stations. You hear these really smooth, svelte, you know, harmony vocals, and it's so peppy. You just feel like life is great. And this is what I grew up in, this time where we felt, you know, we're in paradise here in California with this modernism that's coming, the space age, and go, and everybody's going to be happy, and we have the soundtrack, and it's going to get better and better and better, you know. And then what happened is in came Led Zeppelin, who did play their own instruments, and they came with this very heavy, dark sound, very psychic, mystical, dark mysticism sound. And then that sort of opened along with like Deep Purple and Black Sabbath and all these dark, you know, dark psychic stuff came in, magic stuff, magic music came in with bands playing their own music and taking pride in that, and you know, became raucous and rough and dark and heavy, and you know, the beauty was lost, it was gone. The tastefulness, was a lot of it was gone, and by that time I was already so demoralized, you know. I was just, oh gosh, I could play that music, you know. I could play the hard rock, hard blues, all the stuff. I could sound like they, you know, like that, but not like the real, you know, super popular stuff in the 60s, the really beautiful stuff. No way. And so I'm able to listen to the music with a different ear now, and just a son of a gun, listen to that bass player. I mean, you start listening to that music, and I just realize, oh my gosh, these people are geniuses. These people are really geniuses that are doing this. I mean, every part is done just so cleverly. My goodness. So there you have it. You have a great object lesson of this world. Things are not as they seem. Advertising is not as they seem. Of course, these days you have people can't even sing at all who are getting adjusted. You know, the tone adjustments or whatever they call it, where they're singing and it's so electronically controlled that they can make someone sing live. They can make them sound good when they might be completely out of tune. But they have tune adjusters that make it all sound like it's great. Now, even in the live shows in the 60s, what fooled me too, what was these like live shows that they had on television, Tammy shows, called TAMI, and it was very popular. And they had Jan and Dean on there, Beach Boys, the Ronettes, and a lot of popular groups went through there, Sonny and Cher. So they actually show them up there playing their instruments, you know? And you think, first of all, most of those things, they were lip-syncing. We didn't know about lip-syncing at all. This is something that only came up when like Millie Vanilli or something was doing it. I didn't know about lip syncing. Nobody knew about lip syncing. Kind of like nobody knew about steroids in baseball for a while. Obviously, people hitting so many home runs, and people thought the ball was juiced. I mean, when this huge upsurge in home runs happened in baseball, everybody thought the ball was juiced. I thought the ball was juiced. The commissioner thought the ball was juiced, and they went down to where they make the baseballs. I think it was Dominican Republic or Puerto Rico. It's the factories and stuff, and they had people examining the factories exactly how they made the balls, because everyone was convinced they were winding them tighter and putting more cork in them, and that they were intentionally changing the baseball to make the ball fly farther and get more home runs and make baseball more popular. So for years I insisted, no, the ball's juiced, we know the ball's juiced. The guy broke his bat and the ball flies out, and then eventually, after all these investigations, they said the ball is not juiced, it's the same. And then people said, uh-oh, what's going on? This is weird. And then gradually the whole steroid thing broke. But we as fans did not know about steroids. I did not know about steroids. I was fooled, badly fooled by that. And the whole public was fooled. And apparently the owners and commissioner were fooled too. Apparently. That's what they say. But I can believe it to some extent, because I was certainly fooled. So This is a similar situation that lip syncing. I didn't realize when they were playing live that they had pre-recorded it, and that you were hearing this pre-recording. And so I said, how do they sound so good live? That's another thing that caused me such frustration. I play live and it doesn't sound as good. I can't get the mix, and it just caused me feelings of inferiority, that here's these guys playing the guitar, I can play the guitar as good as they can, and yet they sound so good in a live and I don't. Well, it was pre-recorded. Also mixed in with that, not only did they pre-record it, but in instances where you might say, okay, they're playing live, they had the wrecking crew off to the side at the Tammy show. These genius musicians, they were the ones who were playing. If there was a actual live being played live, the wrecking crew was the musicians playing live off to the side. I never saw them, but they say if you look carefully, you can see down by the pit, orchestra pit or whatever, on the side. Here's the whole wrecking crew, of these genius studio musicians. They're the ones who are actually playing, and you thought the musicians were playing or something. Okay, so it was deceit. And what do they care? They're making tons of money, and corporations are absolutely loving it, and everybody was on a high, except for me. I wasn't on a high, and it's an unusual situation, because I had such confidence in my musicality. I said, I can do anything. Whatever someone sounds, I can sound better. I can sound as good or better. I had absolute confidence in that. And so when I was unable to do it, I just felt like so chagrined and chastised and embarrassed. And my pride was just severely wounded by what happened. To the point I was just moping and it's just a wounded pride, terribly wounded pride. Because I told everybody, and everybody expected me, I had some sort of expectation, I'm going to be able to do great stuff musically, and then I just flopped terribly. And I told people, don't worry, I'm going to be able to do it, musically, and never happened. And they had a lot of faith in me, and they believed in me, and, I didn't pull it off, because they were ignorant, too, of what was going on. And the microphones that we could buy, they're nothing compared to the vintage, the large diaphragm vintage stuff that were made for the studios. It's just like unbelievable sound that they got with the good tubes back then, where the rare, minerals, the rare metals that they used and the way they produced them. Wow, man, that sound was just awesome. And today you can't even buy those kind of tubes. You can't reproduce the sound at all. Not at all. And even some of the studios still have the equipment, and the people who go record in these studios, there are certain studios that make you sound fabulous. Can make you sound fabulous. And others, they don't have the sound. So the recording industry is really magical, almost. It really is. The difference between getting a certain sound and not is takes a lot of little things like Abbey Road Studios, for instance, in England, where the Beatles recorded. I mean, that was used for a classical music recording, and they had the best engineers in the world there, and the Beatles got the best recording studio and the best engineers and the best of everything. And George Martin, of course, producing them to tweak their sound. I mean, you know, there were just some mashers in Germany, you know, playing up the nightclubs. And And they go into Abbey Road and studios. And, you know, they turned out some pretty tasteful music there. And we all thought, oh, yeah, all we got to do is grab that Vox recorder and a Rickenbacker guitar. Yeah, you know, grow your hair long, and we're going to sound like the Beatles. Well, we didn't. and we didn't understand why not. You know, everybody started growing their hairs like the Beatles or the Monkees. And, of course, the Monkees' music was also the Wrecking Crew playing on the Monkees' records for the most part. And the Monkees singing with good, I guess they use good background vocalists too, professionals and stuff. So we failed. And a lot of people gave up. Okay, they grew out of it. They said, you know, I can't. And of course, all the people who loved entertainment at that time, everyone was nuts about it. They hoped, like, hey, yeah, maybe these guys, you know, this group can sound like the Beatles. And so at first they were very enthusiastic about it, and later on they realized, they don't sound anywhere near as good, you know. And so the guys, whoever was doing this, they quit, and they went on with their life and stuff. But for me, I didn't quit. I said, no, I can do it. I just, you know, I'm just can't quite put my finger on what's wrong here, but I'm sure I'm going to get it. So I didn't quit. I just kept trying. And then meanwhile, everybody lost interest in me. So that guy, he sucks. He's terrible. He doesn't sound very good at all, you know. And then you go to the blues and start playing the blues because, you know, that you can sound, well, you can sound somewhat like, you know, you can sound like B.B. King or something if you get a 335. And hollow body guitars, the right hollow body, the right amplifier, you know, you can play the blues and you can sound pretty good. So a lot of us went into blues music. So yeah, we're after the authentic sound, you know, the root sound, you know, because that's the only thing we could get would sound halfway like what we heard on records, right? We couldn't duplicate the other stuff at all. Nobody could. It's ridiculous. I mean, the session players were just the very best players in the world. And what's that guy's name, Burton, that used to play for Elvis, you know, in Elvis's band in Vegas. You know, these guys were, he played for Ricky Nelson. I mean, it's been going on. Ricky Nelson, all his music was, you know, I think, what's his first name? Burton or something. I can't remember his first name, but you can Google it. Ricky Nelson's songs were like fabulous. Hello, Mary Lou, all this stuff. I mean, this the session musicians were playing all that stuff. It wasn't Ricky Nelson playing all that stuff. Ricky Nelson was up there playing his guitar because he's real, you know, all-American guy, and we thought, oh, I can be like Ricky Nelson, you know, no sweat, just get a guitar and learn how to sing and I'll sound like him. No, this is the best players in the world. These guys were incredibly talented at knowing how to produce a record that sounded great. Geniuses. Everly Brothers, you know, the Everly Brothers, they're actually good singers. But, you know, all of these people had these, you know, best session musicians, best recording conditions possible. And then we thought that this was like a musical revolution where any family, all you have to do is buy your kid a guitar. And I said, hey, buy me a guitar. I can do this. I'll figure it out. No problem. And I just started working and, you know, said, yeah, okay, I almost got this song. I learned this song. You know, even John Denver had session musicians playing for him. So this is the secret of the industry. We thought all these artists did their own, you know, did this. We're hearing their own, just, they're just, you know, authentic like that. No. That is the farthest thing from the truth possible. And they hid it from us. And that's not good. It's caused me a great deal of suffering in my life. Now, we get the same thing in religious, spiritual situations where you get front people who are very charismatic personalities, And you've got a lot of production value behind them, like India is known for this, where there's a lot of these quote-unquote gurus who can put on a good song and dance, and you think that, wow, you know, look at this. This is really, they really know what they're talking about. This, and they're not enlightened. They're not enlightened. And we think, hey, you know, I can do what they're doing. For one thing, we underestimate. We think, oh yeah, I can do this. We get a wrong impression because what they're not really enlightened. So we think, well, it's not that difficult. Maybe if I just work on this and I can quote scripture too, and I can talk about the Bhagavad Gita, and I can talk about, you know, Krishna and Arjuna and various things, and I can do the, you know, the Puranas, you know, that give them, talk about the deities and these stories and things like that, and I can chant Om, and I can dress in robes, and I can do this. Maybe I can do this, you know, maybe. And then they have all the production managers, the slick people behind them too, actually very slick people, and they know how to do it, just like Hollywood knows how to produce, you know, movies and music, or India knows how to produce gurus in various places in the world, but use India as an example. And so we thought, you know, that, oh yeah, we can do this. And some actually put on a tricky show and did the guru production thing, but they weren't enlightened. So we did not get a true picture of enlightenment. Actually, we have not gotten a true picture of enlightenment. It's enhanced. What they did was enhanced with a lot of bells and whistles and showmanship and the whole, you know, the whole full Monty of all the whole tradition and everything. Like, we're like, you know, gullible. It's like, wow. And then a lot of people quit because they said, oh, you know, it's I'm not quite getting it. I'm not quite getting the bliss, you know, and they quit. And then, like me, you know, I'm not a quitter. I keep saying, well, I can do that. And so I'm still working at it. But I've realized in getting in touch with real teachers, what it's getting a better idea of what it's actually about. And that's an eye-opener too. It's way beyond the pop guru-ness that we got, you know. I don't want to throw some people's names in, you know, under the bus here, but pretty much what you got during the last 40, 50 years is this pop guru-ness. And, you know, nice song and dance. They made a lot of money. They got a lot of fame, fortune, exploited a lot of people, lived the life of Riley, a lot of them in various ways. Some of them, and here's another thing that's very important to know about this guru-ness, okay, is there's this tradition, I think it's Kathia, it's called, which is called storytelling, based on the Puranas. Now, the Puranas is something that actually arose in I believe, in the Gupta dynasty, which is about, what, 330 CE to 550 CE, where this Puranas were stories, I believe I'm saying that right, I'm not sure, Puranas, where the tradition of storytelling about deities, you know, the Durga, Kali, Vishnu, Rama, Krishna, Shiva, Brahma, Ganesh, Hanuman, on and on, and there's so many, 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 right, stories, all these heroic stories that they're supposed to religiously educate the people. And what happened was the storytelling arose out of this, and a whole professional class of people, storytellers, arose, where they would go around the countryside, the villages, telling stories, and sometimes just in verse, or sometimes with musical accompaniment and various entertainment accompaniment. And so this became a very rich tradition in India throughout the years and the centuries, actually. So the Indians are very used to this sort of storytelling, the song and dance that they get. to illustrate certain moral a lot of moral principles, okay, of right and wrong, and what's pleasing to God and what's not pleasing to God, etc., etc. So there are some very, very skilled storytellers in India. And they can very much seem like gurus to us, actually. In fact, a lot of the gurus in India are just these very brilliant storytellers. Not all of them. For instance, the difference between like Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj or Ramana Maharshi, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, see, those are all legitimate. Lahiri Mahasaya, Yogananda, for instance, I'm not sure exactly what extent, but you know that lineage there, serious, you know, very serious lineage. So there are legitimate enlightened beings in India. There have been for a long time, but there's this storytelling tradition where these storytellers and this tradition, there's some who become very adept at that and very adept at the whole guru show. And the people, of course, they feel, you know, these are like, you know, these are the bigwigs. These are the ones who know God. These are the ones who can tell us about God. They can't tell us about God. They're not enlightened at all. They're not enlightened. Absolutely not. You want to talk about someone's enlightened? Longchenpa, for instance, from the Dzogchen, the great Dzogchen master from Tibet. There's someone who's enlightened. Okay, just listen to the difference to what he says and what these storytelling Indian gurus tell, okay? And of course, they're so good at storytelling, they can blend that stuff in, but it's not the same. It's not the same. So we get a false idea of enlightenment. And we think, oh, okay, it's easy to do, easy enough to do. No, enlightenment, the ones who are enlightened are these geniuses at what they do. They're these dedicated geniuses, very dedicated. It's quite difficult. Even though it seems easy, you know, we should say, well, it seems easy. But if it was, what happened there? If it's that easy, you know, we'd all be there already, right? We'd all be there already. I'd be there already for sure. So it's not that easy. So don't get too discouraged. But it is doable. It is doable. It's the one thing we can do because we all actually are divine. We actually are divine. We can't lose that. It's just a masquerade. So we do have the capability to do it, but it certainly takes dedication, real dedication. Now, you hear people, you know, who've dedicated their whole life to Ramana Maharshi. They have groups and they're still talking about Ramana Maharshi, but they're not enlightened. They're not enlightened. It's, you know, they're working on it still. They're working on it. A real enlightened being doesn't need all the song and dance and the backdrop and all the hoopla and circus and all that kind of stuff. They don't really need it. Because it's just the sheer calm, quietness, silence, presence, poise, everything is based on fact. The real gurus, everything is based on fact for them. They're not storytelling at all. They're not storytelling about some epic Mahabharata or something like that. You know, they're not quoting some Vedic mantra or something. I mean, they are literally right here, right now, seeing divinity. They ask Anandamayi Ma, when you see God, he says, yeah, of course, God's right here. God's everywhere. I see God just as clearly as I see you. He said, this is all based on fact. I'm literally seeing it. There's no effort, he says, but so it's effortless for me. You know, you say, how great I am as a guru. What do you mean I'm not a guru? This is just, you know, I'm not a no storyteller or nothing. I am just seeing this, literally. Those are the real gurus, the ones that literally see it. The fact, they're seeing the facts, plain as day, as plain as we see the sun in the sky, they're seeing God. So, you know, all the confounding tricks that the ego uses doesn't have any effect. You know, imagine if somebody tried to convince you the sun wasn't shining, you know, you just smile and laugh, right? I mean, you wouldn't worry at all about that. And so for them, it's even more obvious that God is all than the sun is shining in the sky. Way more obvious. So how are you going to talk them out of it? You know, no, they don't even, they're not worried about somebody confounding them or anything like that. It's not some mental trick, you know. The real gurus, it's not a mental trick at all. The false ones, of course, you see the false ones are doing all sorts of bogus circus tricks and you know, trying to, you know, wow and awe people and, you know, you can tell the difference if you really want to. But they fool a lot of people. They might do, you know, useful. They're useful maybe in some ways. Is it moral education and education and discipline. I mean, they can be useful. But if you really want enlightenment, you know, I would say you have to find what's truly authentic, truly authentic. So in other words, if you really want to sound good as a musician, if I really wanted to sound good, I would, you know, back then I would have needed to have gone to, you know, the, you know, recording studios in L.A. and get the recce crew to play behind me. Get the producers to arrange the song. I could write the lyrics or whatever. And, you know, they'll say, okay, let's try it, you know, in C minor, or let's do this progression. You know, they'd work out the parts and you know, get recorded. And it, people would say, oh, my God, you're a star. You know, you're a star. Listen to this. Star is born. You know, oh, and what, Sun Studios, too, in Memphis, right? I mean, where Elvis did his recording. I mean, they had some awfully tasteful players there, and they also had the Jordanaires singing background. Along with, you know, with great studio musicians. So, yeah, the great music had this great studio musicians. The whole thing was there. So if you really want enlightenment, you've got to go to the teachers who know what enlightenment really is. Otherwise, it's going to be a pale fake, you know, pale fake. Garage band. You know, people say, oh, yeah, it's a nice garage band. And then the world starts, you know, the problem in the world is starts worshiping garage bands or grunge rock or whatever, you know, stuff that sounds terrible. They say, yeah, I can sound that terrible too. And everyone says, yeah, you know, long live the proletariat, you know, of music, that we can all sound like this, you know, just put, you know, ton of distortion on, and it's how you look and how you present yourself, and then you get this, you know, grungy stuff, and but even that actually had some slick producers and et cetera, et cetera. Don't think it didn't. Don't think people who know how to make money don't know how to you know, package their product. But so, you know, we don't want to fall into this, you know, proletariat kind of zombie fixation of, yeah, we like bad stuff, you know. Yeah, we like people who aren't enlightened giving, you know, their spiritual opinions, and us taking it as if it were gospel. Yeah, we like this crummy religions we have. Yeah, we like, you know, this is like, makes us feel like, you know, our ignorance isn't so bad, that kind of thing. And yeah, we don't really want to make the effort to, you know, really get it done properly, that kind of thing. And that creeps into a society, you know, and then when the real thing comes along, people say, oh, that's, you know, that's too good, we don't really want that sort of thing. And music, it ultimately became that way with, you know, grunge rock and garage bands and where, you know, you just, if you had the right act, so to speak, people would like that. They could identify with it. And then spiritually, we had a lot of teachers like that. And people said, yeah, I just want to, you know, you just have like a mantra. I want to experience the Kundalini, or I want to, you know, I want to like have some lights. I want to see some lights go off in my mind or something like that. I remember someone just told me recently about the concussions that they suffered playing football. And he was talking about the experience he saw, and he saw this blue light, you know, and all that stuff. He said, actually, that means blood, is your brain's bleeding, and this the optic nerve or something, you're seeing that blood or something like that. So a lot of this bells and whistles stuff is not what we may think it to be. It may be just the brain, the blood flow in the brain, the way the nerves are seeing it and stuff like that, and experiencing it. Altered states. When you have a concussion, you also have an altered state. We're not after altered brain states or anything like that at all. No way. No way. What we are after is the mind, the spiritual mind, not the brain, seeing divinity, the spark of divinity in everyone that cannot be hidden. And we're told that the mind can see that. And once we see that, we are liberated. Once we see that, we're liberated from delusion. And that's true liberation. That is true liberation. And we don't have to judge people anymore, at all. We say, hey, it doesn't matter what mask you put on. You can't fool me anymore. I know you're absolutely divine. And therefore, so am I. Everyone is, and therefore, so am I. You can't be fooled at all anymore. It's over. It's finished. You're free. You're liberated from delusion. And this is far, far different than cheap, parlor tricks that breathe through this nostril, breathe through that nostril, try to, do this stuff. It just, what is that? But fortunately for us, we can do this because it's something inherent within our own being. Whereas like the days of going to, gold Western studios or the, what was it? Was it the Capitol building there? Was it Capitol, the studios in that round building right there in downtown Los Angeles? Looked like a stack of records stacked on one another. And I think there was Gold Studio down there too. But those days are gone. Those days are gone. Okay, we're not going to reproduce that sound. Who's that singer? That great singer. Who's sang on some of the, I can't remember her name, but one of the best singers you've never heard, sang on a lot of those girl group songs, and she never got credit for it. She never got credit for it. Yeah, we're talking about the people with the most talent often sometimes are in the very background, and it's the personalities, the glamorous personalities who take the credit for, the success, because they can sell more records. So those days are gone, but the days of enlightenment are not gone. The days of enlightenment are not gone. Okay, they're not. When we think that the time back in Tibet, maybe when they had, pretty isolated from the world and able to produce this tremendous monastic society, that somehow, that was as good as it gets, and those days are gone forever, etc. But it's a little different. The fact is that enlightenment is the same, will be the same for us as it was for them. It doesn't diminish in quality. It's not like some tube microphone that you can't get those tubes anymore. Okay, the quality remains the same. The freshness remains the same. The bliss remains the same. The divinity remains the same. It all remains the same. It hasn't deteriorated the slightest bit. So we can have just as good as a realization right now as they did in Tibet any time, okay, or in India any time of the Buddha, you name it, time of Christ, time of whatever. We can have just as good a realization right now, the quality just as good. So this is very important to start looking at it this way. It is not a technical feat in terms of materiality at all. So the problem is the ego will judge it according to this materialistic mindset and say, well, it's not quite as good back then. It was a different cycle back then. The gravity of the earth was different, or the Schumann resonance was different. Different, chakras were differently activated, and blah, 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 blah. The ego will just, can never handle the truth, can it? The ego can never handle the truth. And that is that the ego doesn't exist, actually. And none of this stuff really truly exists. It's not real. It has no effect on reality. It has no effect on our freedom. Our freedom is perfect right now. Okay? Reality is flawless right now. So the flawlessness of reality has never changed in the slightest bit, and the overlaying of this universe upon the idea of cycles and time, necessary time and alignments, you know, subtle energy, subtle, all this kind of stuff is a masquerade. It's a masquerade. The flawlessness of reality is untouched by this masquerade entirely. This is what the enlightened ones realized, that all of this is just a masquerade. And it doesn't touch reality at all. It's completely flawless. And so that flawlessness is exactly the same now as it was then, so to speak, which is the eternal now. The eternal now is always the same. And so we don't have to worry about these issues of materiality at all. We don't have to worry about our body. We don't have to worry about our moods, our attitudes. We don't have to worry about our concepts. We don't have to worry about where we live. You know, we don't have to worry about exactly what our spiritual path was like. We don't have to worry about our age, our race, gender, social position, degrees, teachers. None of that ultimately has any effect whatsoever on the actual experience. None of it. So, the experience of the Buddha, you can have the exact same experience now, the exact same realization right now. Anyone can. In fact, everyone has to, ultimately. It's like there's this ultimate production studio, spiritual production studio. Everybody that walks in, you know, sounds great. You know, oh, wow, you just hear this and you just say, oh my gosh, what a song. Listen. It's like the silence. Listen to the silence. It's perfect. It's uncorrupted. It's pure. It's pure. It's completely pure. And say, listen to that purity. And that purity is the same purity that anyone at any time also heard and listened to. Listen to that purity. You know, it wasn't more pure because they say, hey, I'm a Tibetan Rinpoche or something, a Lama. I get to get better purity of silence than anyone else. No, it doesn't work like that at all. It doesn't work like that at all. You can just say I'm a nobody. I have a crummy garage band spiritual background, but I've been diligent enough and I've finally able to awaken and hear the silence, so to speak. The quality of the silence will be the same for you as it is for anybody, anyone, any spirit. We have to reorient our expectations in this way. And we don't need to do anything to make that silence pure. It's already pure. Experience is already pure. It'll never be more pure. It'll never be less pure. So the world, those are ignorant, always read into more into it than it that's there, because they use this material world as a foundational preconception or premise, and then say, well, it can't be the same because everything's just changing, you know. So they don't understand that reality doesn't change. It's not based on cycles, you know. It's not like that at all. So back to our theme here of getting this realization into waking sleep. What happens to our waking sleep state then? Well, imagine just like it's like a room, and you've just gone from one room to another, and the other room in your house is still there. And you say, well, it's still there. I'm just not in that room right now. That's all. If I can go there if I need to, if I really need to. But why would I go into a room where facts are not apparent, where the whole purpose of the room is to distort facts so you don't recognize that they're facts? Why go into that room if you can sit in this room where facts are completely obvious? So why not stay in the room where facts are completely obvious? Now, if you do that, then you're enlightened, you're a legitimate guru. And genuine people, seekers will seek you out because they want that also. They truly want that also. Maybe someone will seek you out and say, hey, I got this really charismatic lead singer, so to speak, if you use a music analogy. We got this great charismatic lead singer, but you know, they can really lip sync great, they can, you know, but the problem is they can't really sing, and we need some songs. Can you do the singing, you know? And we just can't really credit you for it because people, you know, they want to think that this charismatic personality is the one who's doing it. So, okay, could you help us out with that, you know? And we'll pay you really well. And actually, they won't pay you so well, but you'll have fun doing it. So that can happen too. And I'm sure that there are many sharp sharks, you know, angling for how do we prop up waking sleep and make it seem groovy enough that we don't really want to bother about worry, ask any tough questions. You know, what this world is dedicated to is not asking any tough questions and not asking any tough questions at all. It's unbelievable to me how the society and the social engineering that's going on here are, what they're adept at is avoiding really tough questions. They avoid examination of their position altogether and just use PR and pressure and legal tactics, etc., to get their way. But the world doesn't want to ask tough questions. They want to avoid it. They want to avoid saying, hey, am I forgetting something? Is this all there is? Or is this like a really shallow, is this like a dream where I feel deprived, very deprived, actually? I'm living on this dusty rock. Is this really what I was created for? To live on this dusty rock in space? That doesn't seem right, does it? That seems kind of very weird. And everybody here says, oh yeah, of course, what are you talking about? Why even think about idiotic stuff like that? It doesn't go anywhere anyway, you know, so it's stupid. So what do you mean? I think it'll go somewhere. I don't think this is my home. What am I doing here? You know, why do I think I'm even here in the first place? It's ridiculous. This isn't my home. The world is dedicated to not asking those questions. So when you do ask those questions, you become an oddball, don't you? You seem like an oddball to everybody. People want to stay away from you. Says, I don't like the questions they ask. You know, that's crazy. Who wants those questions? Babies popping into this world like crazy. You see so many people pushing baby carriages around here, and you know that lots of them are twins. So many twins. It's amazing how many twins are coming into the world. And I guess people feel that you know they're doing the Lord's work, and this is what life is for, is produce more bodies. But I am not a body. I'm not a body. Jesus said the fundamentally most powerful assertion you can ever make is saying, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. He says that is the most effective, quick, direct, powerful assertion you can make. Make it as often as possible during the day, and include it in intensive practice as well, which is what I've been doing. I took this advice to heart, and that is what I'm doing. Now, of course, most people are going to wait and see if it works. But for me, I got nothing else to use. I mean, I don't have anything else. It's this or nothing, really. So I might as well keep using it. Might as well keep using it. Trust in Jesus and keep using it. Now, if it works for me, I expect it will. Then maybe others will say, "Hey, I'm gonna do it also." But usually, you know, when you're pioneering something, most people are kind of skeptical, of course, thinking, "Well, let's wait and see if it works." It's understandable. But I do believe it will work. I do believe it will work. That it pushes through and produces a little bubble here in waking sleep. A little bubble, a little room that I can dwell in. It's a little room. Oh, there's another room in the house I have, you see. And I can dwell in this bubble, this microclimate. And I can say, the old room's right next, right there too. I can go in there if I need to, but I don't really need to right now. So it sort of produced this little bubble. I can live in this sort of little bubble where the truth is present even in waking sleep here. What people will assume is waking sleep, but it may be a bubble of sleeping sleep and actually deep sleep, and then even the fourth state bubbling up through all of those. Imagine like an ocean, and at the bottom of the ocean there's this bubble of oxygen or something that forms, and it stretches and it keeps stretching, it doesn't break, and it goes stretches all the way to the surface like a column of oxygen from the bottom of the ocean all the way to the surface, and it's open to the air there, and it's sort of like that. It's sort of like that where the air and the oxygen of this column become one, so to speak. And those dwellers on the bottom of the ocean, you know, can look at this oxygen and even maybe, you know, breathe a little of it and say, "Wow, you know, what is this?" Imagine if you lived at the bottom of an ocean. You didn't even know about the atmosphere and the oxygen and the atmosphere, that kind of stuff. And then there was this column of somehow oxygen from you know, all the way to the bottom of the ocean. Maybe it came from the atmosphere stretching down through the ocean to the bottom of the ocean, either way. And you get to, you know, experience a little bit of it and say, "Wow, I feel so much better when I get this much oxygen," you know. Maybe it carries with it the fragrance of the atmosphere, right? The light of the atmosphere. Carries with it the qualities of the atmosphere. And these qualities are so different than what we're used to in the bottom of the ocean, which is cold, dark, pressure, you know, there's all this murkiness. And here's this bright, fresh oxygen, column of oxygen. So this has to dome into waking sleep here, the land of the zombies. It's the antidote for being a zombie. And maybe some people said, "You know what? I'm tired of being a zombie." And the others will say, "Once a zombie, always a zombie. You know, what are you talking about? You're crazy. You're a zombie now. You belong to us. Once a zombie, always a zombie." And you say, "Nah, you know what? I got a feeling like actually this is all just a masquerade. I'm just kidding around here. I'm just pretending to be. In fact, you are too." So I'm going to take some of this oxygen, spiritual oxygen. And then they say, "Oh, wow, yeah. I'm not really a zombie, am I?" It's hip to be a zombie these days, isn't it? Very hip in the world. And actually, all these zombies, they're all celebrating their zombiness, you know, saying, they're saying, now we finally realized, we finally had our enlightenment realization that zombieism is forever. You know, that's the realization they're after. They think that's what enlightenment really is to finally see and know that they're zombies forever. And they can't ever change. And they say, oh, what a great relief, because in the back of my mind, I've had these weird dreams that, like, I can't understand them, you know, that seem to be some weird condition that's not a zombie, and I don't understand, it scares me. But now I have so many brothers and sisters zombies here that all tell me, oh no, for sure, that it's zombieism is forever, and we're all celebrating it, having parades about it, and, you know, the whole world's in a big hoopla about it. Zombieism is forever. And then they say, we finally reached an enlightened civilization, society, and we realize that all these dreams and in sleep and deep sleep, that's all mythical. It's all delusional. It's all a product of deranged brain chemistry and genetics, etc. And we're going to be able to fix that now, finally. And everyone will say, wow, that's great. I always thought I might be a true zombie. You know, now I realize I am. And that's what you have, people. And they're taking zombie, you know, food, which are, you know, pharmaceuticals, constantly taking those and acting like zombies, you know, like what they do, their whole moral structure and all. And they say, yeah, once they realize, well, we're always zombies, we might as well become really adept zombies then, right? We might, you know, let's go full blast. And that's what's going to happen soon in this world is, I think about June 21st, 2016, is by that time, there will be this collective mindset in the world that, hey, we're all true zombies. We're all real zombies. There's no way we can ever not be. Hallelujah. You know, we finally realize this. We don't need this religion. We don't need this spirituality. We don't need this stuff. Now we can finally get rid of it. You know, because before we thought, well, maybe we might need it because these weird dreams we're having. But now we finally realize, no, that's all bad brain chemistry, and the pharmaceutical companies have convinced us. They tell us now they have the medicines. They have the treatments. They have the genetics. Treatments that will cure us of these terrible dreams that we've been having for so long of, you know, that we're not zombies, that we might be something else. But now we know we have the cure, so we don't need religion, we don't need spirituality, we don't need any of this stuff. Let's finally get rid of it. Good riddance, they will say. Good riddance. It's an archaic vestigial appendix, they say. And this is the mounting zeitgeist of the times right now. You see it everywhere in people's opinions, and they say, you know, all that's wrong with this world is those religious nuts. Get rid of them, and we will be happy zombies. Smart, intelligent, happy zombies. And they're just chomping at the bit for that day, and they know their day is soon. The sign of Jonah has already been given. Kaboom, you know. They blew up Jonah's mosque in Mosul. And of course, zombies love death, don't they? Yeah. Now, the right to die is, again, getting very intense pushing. Assisted suicide, right to die, all this kind of stuff. And they're trying to, you know, push that through. We'll have zombie death parties where they all bring the medications and they, here, let me give you some morphine. Let me give you a little more. Oh, thank you. Bless you, brother zombie, sister zombie. I'm so blessed to have such friends. They, oh, some more morphine or whatever they do. they probably put in the IV or something. But yeah, they all can hang around and help our friends commit suicide. Our fellow zombies. We're us poor, ignorant, mythical, deranged brain chemistry morons will merely simply turn into clear light. What is that? That's mythical, they'll say. That's mythical. We'll just vanish, you know, in clear light. Go to greener pastures. The death-free realm. They say, how deprived those idiots are. You know, they could have actually had, you know, morphine here, and then we could, people sit around and watch the body decay and feel good about that, you know. You know, learned how I learned to love rot, how I learned to love decay. You know, the zombies will have their music, you know, to just help them adjust to death and decay and sickness and make them feel righteous about it. So we're almost there. We're almost there. Almost there. And they say, you can't be enlightened because you gotta die. Your body has to decay. You're part of nature. You know, nature made you. You're part of the cycle. You can't leave that. You're part of time, space, process, and form. And of course, Jesus tells us, no, you're not. I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. There is no time, space, process, or form, actually. That's a dream. That's a pretension. That's a masquerade. That's a request on our part. A request that we made so that we can then claim, hey, God, we didn't ask for this. How can you say we asked for this? You're crazy. Something happened. You gave us something we didn't want. There's a problem with reality, God. If you didn't give us something that we didn't want, then something's interfering with reality. Yeah, some evil, there's something interfering in reality. And what I requested from you, I didn't get. So there's something wrong. It's a problem with reality. And since I'm the one who found this problem out with reality, I must be greater than you, God, because my awareness is greater because you weren't aware of it. See, and then spirit believes that its little game, its little gambit is worked because it now feels superior to God, at least from the standpoint of righteousness. But it's only righteousness. It doesn't actually feel superior, but it has this self-righteousness now that, hey, I found a flaw in reality, God. I asked for something, you gave me something different. And God says, no, I gave you exactly what you asked for. And you said, what are you talking about? Are you kidding? I'm sitting here rotting and decaying and with fungus and infections and bacteria and I'm dying. And you tell me this is what I asked for? You're crazy. No way could I ask for that. You definitely gave me, reality definitely gave me something I didn't ask for. God says, no, you asked for this. He said, no, God, it's not possible. What are you, crazy? And so this is how spirit, you know, pretends that it's superior to God. This is how it tries to complete its game of how do I become superior to God? By saying that reality has a problem. God's not perfect. By asking for stuff like that, what we've asked for is terrible stuff, and then claiming, I couldn't have possibly asked for that. God, no way, no way, no way. It's just a silly little game, you know, a little child would play, actually. You think the parents are fooled by that? No. It's like the child says to the parent, I want peas, I want peas, I want peas, I want you to serve me peas, you know. So the parent says, okay, you ask peas, okay, here's the peas, nicely cooked, everything's perfect. And the child tastes the peas and says, I hate peas. I can't stand peas. They're terrible peas. Why did you give me peas? You must hate me. You know, I didn't ask for peas. I wanted ice cream. I always want ice cream. I love ice cream. Why did you serve me something I hate? I hate you. You know, you're terrible. And the child goes storming off to their room. You know, the parents say, what do you mean? What do you, you know, you asked for peas and you really wanted peas. You insisted on it. We gave you peas. And we know you don't like peas, but, you know, we give you what, if you ask for us and insist, then we'll guess what we give you. The child's moping in its room, so upset. I'm not coming out of my room until you apologize for giving me peas. You made a big mistake. And then the child later on says, okay, I'm going to come out of my room. I think I'm going to come out of my room now, but before you do that, I have to tell you what happened. I think I know what happened. It's not your fault. I apologize for getting upset with you, and it's certainly not my fault. I mean, I didn't make any requests for peace. I know that for a fact, and I know that you probably didn't you didn't hear what I requested. So what happened was there's something interfered with my request. I asked for peas and something interfered with your hearing and you heard. I mean, actually, he said, I asked for ice cream and you heard peas. That's why he gave me peas. Or I asked for ice cream, you heard ice cream, and as you gave it back to me, the ice cream, someone interfered with it and changed it into peas. That's why. So I forgive you, God. I forgive myself. You know, but we have to get rid of this interloper who's this interferer who's interfering with reality, you know, it's interfering. So I'm ready to come out of my door, God, but if you agree that together we've got to destroy and defeat this terrible interference that is causing you to give me things I didn't ask for. Okay, can I come out of my room now? Do you accept that? Do you agree? What the parents gonna say? They're gonna say, you know, you better stay in your room for a little while and rethink that one. What are you talking about? How ungrateful can you possibly be? I make this great breakthrough and seeing what must have happened, and you reject it. That means you really did get, you know, intentionally give me peas that I hated. You see, I just proved it, you know. And then the child goes in another tantrum, extremely angry tantrum. And when finally the kid gets tired of the tantrum, it's just, I says, what do? I want to come out of this room. This room's terrible. It says, God, what? If I said, God, what happened? Do you know what happened? And God says, sure, I know what happened. But you got to be willing to accept it. It's okay, what happened? You asked for peas, I gave you peas. And they say, well, why the heck would I ask for peas when I hate peas? So you ask for peas so that you could then, knowing that you hate them, so then you could then claim that there's no way you asked for peas, that you must have asked for ice cream, so then you can point out that I made a mistake. And so then since I made a mistake, you can claim, see, you're not all perfect, you're all not all knowing, you're not really God at all, I'm actually greater than you because I didn't make a mistake. I asked for the ice cream and you made the mistake, God, not me. And so this is a little game that we're playing with God, actually. This is a little game that we're playing with God. And God's not playing the game. You know, we're playing the game, but God's not playing any game. God just says, well, you know, truth is true. And there's no interference. There's no interferer. There's nothing interfering with reality, with experiencing. All experience is pure, uninterfered, undistorted. Perfectly natural, always the way it's always been. There's nothing wrong. Everything is getting exactly what it requests. So all is perfect with reality, all is well. So come on out of the room and whatever you request, that's what you will receive. There are no problems. Don't worry. And so we're still moping. You know, we're still moping that our little game hasn't worked properly. We blame it on, we project and blame others. We say, well, this person or that did it, or this one interfered, or this distorted, or this one caused you to hear improperly, or that one, you know, but all these things we do except just admit the truth. That all we have to do is say, hey, God, yeah, I think I got it right. I asked for peas because I hate peas, okay? And I knew you would give me peas because you always give me what I asked for. And then what I'd set up to do was I would claim that because I hate peas so much that there's no way I could have ever asked for it. Therefore, I must have been asking for ice cream instead, and you heard wrong. You made a mistake and gave me peas. And I wanted to claim that you made a mistake. I didn't make a mistake. You did make a mistake. Therefore, I wanted to claim I'm greater than you. That's, I believe, God, that's exactly what I did. And God will say, yeah, that's exactly what you did. Yeah. And that God says, you can come out whenever you want to, it's fine. And then you think, huh, I don't really have to stay in this room, do I? No. God says, yeah, that's exactly what happened. You know what happened now. So you're totally clear about it. And all is fine. Always has been. No worries. I'm not upset. No upset at all. It's just you ran this little scheme that was, you know, funny little scheme. That's all. So we ask for time, space, process, and form, at least this mirage of it. We didn't ask for something else and God gave us this and we're stuck with it. Or we're stuck with a God that when we ask for something else, God gives us this. You know, obviously, if that's the case, we say we got to fix God. God's got a problem. So the way we're looking at it, either we fix this interference that's causing a problem, or we fix God. One of the two. One of the two. So a lot of people think that fixing God is to stop believing in God. Said, God, I'm just going to ignore you for a while, and hopefully that will cause you to change your mind and admit that you made a mistake. And the others say, no, there's this terrible interfere, God. Don't worry, we still love you, but there's this terrible interfere that is changing reality against your will and my will, and we need to defeat that interfere. You know, we got to get rid of this evil doer, you know, this interference. And then you have that sort who go that way. And then you have the others who think, well, God, you know, something went wrong, and it was my mistake. You know, God, it was my fault. You made the mistake, God, but I'm to blame because I caused you to make the mistake. Because I'm sinful, I'm bad. And you said, you know what? I'm not going to give them what they really asked for. I'm going to give them what they don't want because they're sinful and they're bad. And I'm going to teach them a lesson. So I'm so sorry, God, that I'm so sinful and awful that you would give me what I didn't ask for. And I beg you to forgive me for how I sinned against you and how evil I've been towards you. And I know it's really unforgivable. You can never, but if you could at least, you know, try to at least forgive me anyway, knowing that I don't deserve it in the slightest bit, and then when I ask for what I want, you'll be sure to give it to me in the future, if that's possible, God. So we try to, you know, fearfully propitiate a God that we think definitely didn't give us what we asked for, but God had a reason. You know, God works in mysterious ways, and of course we're sinful, or we just simply don't understand. You know, we're just not able to understand God. So that's another way we say, well, God, I asked for this, and you gave me that, and I don't really want that at all, but there must be a reason you gave it to me. I just don't understand it. It's a mystery. You know, I'm working on solving the mystery. I'm trying to understand. You know, we're doing a lot of scientific experiments. We're a lot digging into this universe, and somewhere we know we're going to find the answer somewhere, buried, hidden somewhere. I'm going to finally realize, you know, why you gave me this instead of what I asked for. You know, if we're going to resolve that mystery. So all of this stuff is completely bogus, you see, and yet we all take all these clever little, you know, sideshow, you know, stuff. Got all these little sideshow, you know, the carnival. You got all these sideshow. Come on, throw the dime on the glass. Throw the ball at that, and then here, toss this, throw this, whatever. Come on, you can do it. And we get all caught up in this, you know, all these sideshow stuff. Don't get to the main event, the big tent. So these are some of the tricky ways that we're working it. And some say, well, God, since you didn't give me what I want, I'm just going to stop believing you, and altogether, you don't even exist. And because you don't exist, you can't give me what I don't want. And I'm going to turn this world into what I really want, and you're out of the picture, God. You know, I have nothing more to do. I don't have anything more to do with you. You're incorrigible. And so I will simply say you don't exist, and I'll make this into a paradise, and I'll have the last laugh, God. You know, this is another ploy we use. This is what a lot of the world's up to, right? The combination of all these various factors, but to greater or lesser degrees, these funny little gambits we use. Whereas all we have to do is just admit the truth that God says, God, you gave me exactly what I asked for. Thank you very much. I was trying to run a little trick on you by claiming that asking for something I didn't want, and then claiming, therefore, you couldn't have possibly given it. You know, you couldn't have. You didn't give me what I really asked for, and therefore, you know, you made a mistake, and therefore I'm greater than you. That's exactly what I did, God. I know you've always been completely true. There's no sin. I didn't do anything to upset you. Okay, there's no interfere. There's nothing that interfered with the request whatsoever. You're not working in any mysterious ways. You're completely plain and straightforward, you know, so that none of that happened. It's exactly what happened. It's exactly what I'm admitting to what happened. And then all that other stuff is out the window, right? You're not sinful. You didn't anger God. God is not incompetent. There's not some interferer. There's not some communication problem. There's not some mystery. It's not like you're some someone who's been dumped here in some evolutionary plan of God where you have to go jump through all these bells and whistles and go through all this hell and misery to raise your consciousness, and you didn't ask for any of this, but that God forced this upon you, and this is what you have to do. None of that is true. None of that is true. You're flawless right now. Your experiencing is pure. It's perfect right now. Anything you ask, you shall receive right now. You are a flawless divinity, created that way, complete sovereign of your own experiencing, absolutely free. And that is the truth. And all you have to do is confess this to God, admit this to God, recognize it, see it. Say, yeah, this is exactly what's going on. How are we doing on this taping? Okay, going along nicely so far. It's recording. That's nice to see. I just hope the audio is recorded. That's a problem I had in the previous one. Two videos. But the audio, one video, the video never recorded. It showed it was capturing it, and it didn't. This one, at least it has a little pie chart that shows the memory card I'm using, and it shows that it's you know, using memory on that. So that helps me out. It's like 3 gigabytes so far. I thought this recording, sometimes that's what it's showing. Probably more than that. I can see what it says. Oh, 3.05. That's not bad. Interesting. 241 video duration. Well, okay. Oh, I see. Okay, I see what it's doing. A little bit new with this system here, but at least it seems to be working. And hopefully this is not lost. This video is not lost. If it is, I might get kind of unhappy about that, because it takes a lot of effort and energy and focus to do this, and to just have all those hours just gobbled up for, you know, and gone is tough. Very tough. So we're doing a little bit of the wow phase right now, sort of cooling off on the wow, full stop on the wow, because this information is pretty potent stuff. Very potent stuff. Yeah, but again, what's our goal? That bubble, let that bubble form in waking sleep. And that bubble is like, into the bubble, we look at the bubble and say, hey, I see clear light. Oh, what is this light? You know, like, wow, I see the clear light that comes from, clear light has bubbled up through deep sleep, and now into waking sleep. And you say, wow, this is a nice, you know, nice bubble. I don't want to pop that bubble. Oh, I know the name of that singer for the Ronette. Darlene Love. Yeah, Darlene Love sang a lot of the records. You know, some of the big hit records. Great singer. Didn't get credited for it. A lot of chicanery. Had to sue later on. A lot of the musicians had to sue. Wow. Yeah, the corporations told us that we're all going to be happy back then, and they gave us happy music and said, even the commercials were fabulous. It just, wow, says, you know, we have this these cars for you now, and this fast food, and we have this, you know, soft drinks for you, and we have aluminum cans for you, and we got everything for you. And you know what? You're going to be so happy, you're going to be skipping down the road singing a song, actually. And here's, this is like the song you'll be singing. And you say, wow, that's great. Let me drink a six-pack of this Coca-Cola or Pepsi or whatever. And, hey, I do feel kind of peppy, actually. Of course, we didn't even know back then there was caffeine in it, tell you the truth. We were told there's sugar, soft drinks, sugar water. You know, it's good for you. It was marketed like, wow, this is like Coke adds life, is one of the mottos, right? Coca-Cola adds life. You know, I want to teach the world to sing in perfect harmony. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And have a Coke and a smile. You know, they have these, all these people holding hands on a hilltop, you know, aerial shots, and everybody's, and I want to teach the world to sing in perfect harmony. And, yeah, you drink a six-pack of Coke. Back then, and you're feeling pretty energetic, pretty peppy, and you do start, you know, say, hey, give me that hula hoop, man. I'm with it. I'm I feel like skipping down the road and singing a song. I feel like, hey, you know, I do feel like saying, I want to go work for a corporation. I want to work night and day. As a matter of fact, I mean, I don't even want to sleep. I feel so privileged to be part of this miracle that we're transforming the world into this perfect place, because after all, God hasn't done us wrong, you know, and so we're gonna prove something to God, I'll tell you that. And I'm gonna go work at this corporation. I'm gonna work around the clock, and I don't need to sleep. And we'll just have called take in McDonald's, take in, we'll just call them. I don't know if McDonald's didn't deliver, but we can send someone down, send a courier down, bring back, you know, two double patties, hot special sauce and cheese, you know, and Coca-Cola, and we're cooking all night here. We're cooking with gas now. And that was what it was like. I mean, we felt like go, 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 go. That's why they had go-go girls, actually, you know. Just, hey, you know, I can't slow down. The go-go girls, they never slowed down. They say, I can't slow down. And they're just dancing all night up in those bird cages there, you know. Just, it's just, you know, just like, wow, I got so much energy. I just like, I'm like tribal, you know. It's like, I'm drinking soma, drinking ephedra, you know, pounding the stalks of ephedra and having the Vedic soma ceremonies presided over by the Brahmins. And now I feel like I'm a world beater. I'm going to go conquer worlds. Yeah, there's the go-go girls, just wow, you know, just stretching and bending and leaping and so gyrating, and just like, I'm ready to fly. I'm about ready to fly. You know, fly me to the moon and back. And of course, everything was getting to be aluminum, 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 aluminum. And aluminum and everything light, 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 light. Look at this. Look at this can. My God, this is only a bottle. Look at this aluminum can. I mean, this must be like rocket fuel, this sort of spiritual rocket fuel for me or something. And I feel all rocketed up. And I said, I'm turning into a rocket here. I'm a rocket man. And, yeah, everyone was hyped up. Everyone was high hyped up. It went from these dreamy time of the 50s, the dreamy girls, the romantic, boom, 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 woo, 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 wah, wah, you know, doo-wah, doo, 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 you know, and the Letterman sweaters, and they sit there dreamy, just looking at the stars, driving, oh, it's so beautiful, I'm so dreamy, it's so romantic. We went from that to go-go girls with the white boots, mini skirts, and just shaking their heads like they just, you know, having a seizure. They say everybody can have seizures. Seizures are fun. Epileptic seizures are fun, but, you know, everyone's having epileptic seizures. Says, wow, you know, this is like we're spacing out here. And it got more and more and more and more intense, of course, as the drugs got more and more intense. And of course, everyone was mixing drugs. They're mixing, you know, chugging Pepsi and Coke and whatever caffeinated coffee, whatever, and then drinking alcohol of all sorts, and then taking other drugs of all sorts, amphetamines of all sorts. I mean, they're just, you know, they're just mixing all these drugs together. Taking mushrooms, taking peyote, taking LSD, orange sunshine, same thing, mescaline, you know, you name it, heroin, cocaine came later on, but marijuana, you know, people were just, in the scenes were just mixing, and their system always, you know, was having all the, you know, this stuff in it. And so, of course, they're like, wow. It's like, let's get crazy, you know, get crazy. I feel like a love-in. Of course they felt like a love-in, you know. They were feeling tribal. Let's form a tribal circle here. You know, wah, wah, doosie. Let's do the wah, wah, doosie. And, you know, they got this all like tribal. We can get back to our roots, and we can celebrate the earth, and we can figure out, you know, how to do a tribal dance properly. You know, and we've got everyone's wearing, you know, ghost dance shirts. You know, the bullets are impenetrable. You know, the bullet of fatigue, the bullet of Father Time cannot penetrate these ghost shirts that we're wearing as we're doing our new ghost dance. The wah wah tusi, and the swim, and the frug, and the can you do the, you know, can you do this, the shingling and the shake and the twist and the shout, twist and so everybody's twisting and shouting and this is happening. And they, you know, hey, we're invincible. We're invincible. We have the drugs now to help us be invincible. I mean, we're really going back to the soma, the trying to, you know, come back to the soma age, because of course the Vedas, the first Veda was a Rig Veda. I think it was pretty much, is that the one that was like, maybe there was a third one that was dedicated to soma, but one of the Vedas, the four Vedas, was dedicated to the soma ceremony. I mean, the soma ceremony was all important in the times of the Rishis and the Vedas and Indo-Aryan Proto-India civilization, early times. And that was all, it was like super, super important, because it got you in touch with Indra, you know, the gods and the deities, and we became like, you know, supercharged. And so it was centered on an ethnogen, or what do you call it, you know, plant substance. It wasn't cannabis, because you don't get the effect of cannabis out of pounding the stalks. They said to base, how do you prepare soma? By pounding the stalks in water and putting it through a bunch of filtration and stuff like that. So it came out of the stalks of the plant. That's not where you get the THC from cannabis at all. So there's a lot of people saying that cannabis was soma. No, that's ridiculous. And cannabis is not a stimulant like that anyway. Just want to sit there and just, oh, you know, soma was some intense upper stimulant, you know, visions of God, and I'm you know, super. I've turned into a super person, you know, superhuman or something like that. So, and it wasn't Amida Muscara, the mushroom or something either. No, it's not that either. So, yeah, you know, some plant that may be almost extinct now or something, right? Because later on they said we can't find it. Later on, you know, they had to substitute stuff for soma, because soma stopped being available. Now, how in the world can anybody believe that cannabis somehow became unavailable in that area? I mean, hemp grew wild all over the place there. The notion that somehow the soma ceremonies had to stop, and had to substitute other sacrifices and stuff for soma because it was no longer available, to think that as cannabis is absolutely ridiculous. Cannabis, first of all, it puts off tons of seeds. The seeds easily germinate. You can plant them anywhere that is wild, grows wild everywhere. They would easily have access to cannabis back in the old times. Easily. It's ludicrous to say it was cannabis. It was a plant that was hard, you know, in some sort of climate. It is climate sensitive plant probably, and the climate may have shifted to a certain point where the plant, you know, died out, because they couldn't make soma anymore. They could not make soma anymore. And so they had to do all sorts of mantras, more different mantras and yantras, and Brahmins had to write fire sacrifice, you know, which is, You know, then finally, the end of the Vedas, Vedanta came along, and Shankara, you know, and his lineage finally said, hey, you know, let's, well, actually Buddhism came along and said, you know, let's get enlightenment here. Come on, let's get this done. But that was Buddhism, and Shankara came along and says, let's, the Advaita Vedanta is, you know, that's the end of the Vedas. all these incantations for good health, fertility, long life, wealth, having a good relationship with God, and solving your sinful relationship with God or whatever, you know, is the stuff we've done in this world. The stuff we've done here is just quite a masquerade. We'll have a good laugh at it at some point. And we're already having a good laugh here. And what Shankara said is, of course, you know, the individual self and God, Brahman, are the same. They're not distinguishable. It's all one. And of course, because reality is flawless, and whatever we ask for, we receive concurrently. There's no interference at all. So as Shankara is saying, there's no interference. All experiencing is flawless. So there's no way to differentiate the individual self, quote unquote, the individual self, and God. There's no true differentiation there in the way that I've been trying to think about it at all. All is one. It's all flawless. You know, we the functioning of reality is perfect, is flawless. This is basically a way of saying, you know, God is the world. We are the world, God is the world, all is the world. It's all one. There's no differentiation, because there is no interference. There is no need to propitiate God. There is no need to get rid of some evil interloper. There is no need. We're already in perfect harmony with God. Our experiencing, everything's already in perfect harmony. Everything is already perfect. But of course, if we're going to be pointing out problems to God, if we're going to be pointing out remedies, if we're going to be making complaints, we have to see ourselves as somehow a different, separate from God, right? If we want to be greater than God, don't we have to be someone who's more aware than God, who said, wait a minute, God, I see a problem, and so I can't be, you know, one with you, God, because I see a problem. So somehow we're imagining that we're apart, separate from God. Separate from the functioning that is reality. So we believe we're separate from, even though we're not. Even at this moment, we're not separate. No one is. This is the snake and rope delusion, is we think we're a snake. The snake is there. The snake is there. You know, the problem is there. The interference is there. Reality is not reality. What happened to the rope? Reality is not reality. And then you look again, you say, oh my gosh, there's the rope. How did the rope come back? You know, and this is another problem we have. It says, well, that's great. I'm so happy that the rope is back. This is what the ego says. Oh, wonderful, the rope is back. That's great. How did you get rid of the snake? You know, what happened to it? Did you find the incantation that destroyed it? Or did you, bury it somewhere? How are you sure it's not going to come back on you? And, you know, he says, well, the snake was never there, actually. That's, I realized, oh, I only wanted to believe it was there, so I hallucinated it. You know, or not even hallucinate, it's just that I presumed that the snake was there. So the hallucination arose to support my, you know, belief and desire. But there's never any real snake there at all. It was just a symbol of my desire. So nothing had to be done to overcome the snake or get rid of it. So I am not a body, I am free, I am a still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am a still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. This sets us on the same page with God. And the more we do this, I believe this will produce this bubble of the clear light of truth. Bubble into waking sleep, which is the condition that we are in right now as we're talking, as we're listening to this, as you know, as we, and then later, you know, later on we'll go into sleeping sleep. And we may have a dream where everything becomes completely clear to us. And we even feel blissful. We think, oh, I've got it. And then you start waking, going to waking sleep again. And you say, wait a minute, what's happening to my bliss, my clarity? What, it seems to be fading. Then you wake up and it's just a memory. And then you go about your day and you've forgotten it altogether. Then you say, what happened? This isn't what I asked for. This is unfair. Of course we want the memory of God's perfection to fade away and disappear here, because we're trying to prove that God is not perfect. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to prove that God is not perfect with all this nonsense. So I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Or we can say, God, I know I'm not a body. I know I'm not a body. I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. God, I already know I'm not a body. I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as you created me. God, I already know that I am not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as you created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as you created me. Or, God, I already know that I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as you created me. Keep working on this bubble. And when we see it's all a masquerade, all designed to try and change reality and make reality imperfect, and we realize we can't do that, then why should we keep playing this silly masquerade if we don't really want to? It really hasn't been very pleasant. We say, no, I don't have to do that anymore. It's ridiculous. It's futile to try and pin a mistake on God. So why should I keep asking for stuff I don't want in order to try to pin a mistake on God? That's just, it doesn't, no longer the game's up. That's ridiculous. So we don't have to worry about, oh, we're going to keep coming back to this world forever, even if we're enlightened because we enjoy it so much. And, you know, no. We could come back as a out of compassion, enlightened compassion, but we're not going to just come back here for fun. There's a lot better fun to be had in not trying to pull this con on God. That's for sure. Jesus tells us we can't even imagine it. He said the glory bliss and joy that we have is I'm not going to even bother trying to explain it to you, because you won't be able to even believe it. No way. So he said, don't worry about it. Eventually, you know, you'll find out. So full stop on the wow. Remember, we always, everything is in the context of the practice. The practice is the guru. And the three aspects of that practice is assertion, full stop on the wow, and flipping the script. And this information, you know, soaks in. We just like, it's so tremendous that we get this feeling of wow, I don't know what to do with my expectations, what with my familiarity. The landscape is changing so quickly now. It's just so abrupt and transformative. You know, it's just, I'm in a whole, I'm seeing things in a completely different way right now. This produces a wow, saying, hey, wait a minute, slow down, maybe you should slow down a little bit. I'm kind of just like, whoa. This is really new landscape I'm looking at here. And it is. That's the point of spiritual practice, is get to, make sure you get the new landscape as you practice. Just keep working on it. Don't give up. And then you get used to the new landscape, so it becomes easier and easier and easier for you. You feel comfortable there. You say, okay, this is my new camp. Times change in the world, don't they? I mean, I remember we used to just, the stars just blew our minds. You know, just watch, just look at the stars. Just, wow, what a show. You know, what a show. Now, it's like I never even think of the stars, because there's so much ambient light around here. You can't even see them. Hardly see them. And so, basically, we've just forgotten all about the stars. Like, I never even hardly ever crossed my mind the stars at all. But I remember I went to the desert one night. Went outside, and I was just like completely stunned. I just couldn't believe it. You know, there's like these just jewels, just this jeweled like sky. I just stunned by it. I just stunned. But so here, and the ancients, of course, they paid enormous attention to the stars. They were obsessed by the stars. And the movement of the stars and everything. I guess that's, you know, that's what they had to do. Back then, it's like that was entertainment. Let's keep track of the stars. And knew when eclipses would come. They figured out that, you know, the cycles and everything was amazing. But not nowadays. Oh, wow, we hardly even know the stars exist. So, just like that, we hardly even know enlightenment exists right now, right? Before, it used to be, people would realize it exists, and what a great, you know, jewel to reach that. And it was the aspiration of many. And many did it. And many said, you know what, I can do it too. And they did it too. And people were very tuned into that. Nowadays, it's like there's so much ambient distraction that who pays attention to that? It's like, where, what enlightenment? What are you talking about? Oh, you mean that Ayurvedic thing? Or, oh, yeah. You know, it's, yeah, I'm doing some yoga, and I've gone to an Ayurvedic lecture, yeah, and I'm pretty hip and tuned in to stuff. This is, I understand spirituality. You got to eat like the right foods that are resonate with personality, and then do the right yogic postures, and then go to some power sites. Bless, get the blessing of the teacher, and yeah, that's pretty much fills out the dance card there, right? Checks all the boxes. What else is there? What other box is there to check? Maybe, you know, read a book, best-selling book, and then, all the boxes check. I feel great. I feel like I don't need to ask any more questions. And, just need to, you know, make a little more money. There you have it. It's the modern world. Modern world. They'll get it figured out. No worries. It's like the water situation. People say, well, they'll get it figured out. Don't worry. They'll get it all figured out. You know, what is this, Apple? You know, is Apple designing some new gadgets? Oh, don't worry. They'll get it figured out. A couple of years, they'll have it on market, and it'll be great. Don't worry. So it's like our water problem. It's just like they say, yeah, we'll just get it figured out. Some kind of, you know, engineering software problem. You know, we'll be able to get it figured out here. Really? So this water problem is, all you got to do is just get better software for, yeah, we wasted a lot too much water. If we weren't wasting the water, everything would be fine. Really? So that's the answer, huh? Well, we just don't know how to distribute it properly. If we just distribute it properly, everything would be fine. Oh. So in other words, there's always technology to the rescue here. Mm. 1 minute, please. Okay. Little big interference there. I don't have a pause button here. So yeah, we'll figure out the route. We'll get the right software, the right engineer. Everything will be fine. Oh, really? Well, where's the desalinization plants? We don't have any. Yeah. Where's the water going to come from? We'll figure that out. Well, where exactly is it going to come from? it's a software problem. Really? It's a software problem? Just have to have proper allocation. Really? So, like, if there's no water, there's still a way to properly allocate it? You can allocate zero properly? How do you do that? It's an engineering problem. Don't worry about it. We'll get the engineers working on it. Well, okay, everybody gets one drop. Two drops. Delivered by maybe the 3D printer will print water for us, you know? Just print your own water. Better start figuring out how to suck it out of the air, actually. I think we need to get some big tarps and some, you know, 50-gallon drums. I mean, there's a ton of dew in the morning, I'm telling you. A ton of dew. Better start figuring out ways to have that dew run off into some storage thing. Really. Seriously. Like camping. So you can at least have half a liter of water a day or something. Recycle wastewater. We'll be drinking wastewater. All the nature, you know, the nature people, there'll be all these people, all these, you know, self-styled health gurus. Everybody will be drinking their own urine. Come pretty soon and say, that's really healthy for you, really good for you. That's like green recycling. That's the ultimate in green recycling. Sure. Yeah, that's already some health care thing, right? Sure, that's actually Mother Nature's just helping us out here. We need to recycle, need to do that, and that's going to help your health and probably enlighten you too, they'll say. They'll say, no, this is a good learning experience here. It's very good. It learns how to get along with one another, how to cooperate with one another. In fact, this is just yeah, really, really great. Yeah, but everyone's yard is dead. Well, put in a Zen rock garden, just get into Zen. Yeah, rock gardens, actually. That may be happening. That may happen. I was thinking about this morning putting in a, put in a rock garden or something, right? There's no water to water anything. Get some stones and some pebbles and you rake it a certain way. And of course, yeah, that may be the next big thing. Or have bocce, turn all your garden lawns into bocce ball courts. That'll be the next craze. Some next craze will come along. People are always looking for some trend like that. What's the next trend in California? Ghost dancing, maybe. Rain dancing, maybe. Hey, some of the Indians said they could make it rain, actually. In fact, the guy that started the ghost dance was a weather wizard who could make it rain. Could make ice fall out of the sky, could do all sorts of stuff with the weather. Some of the Indians apparently knew how to control the weather. Maybe they're getting their revenge right now on us by preventing rain, psychically. There's all these psychic Indians in the psychic realm, the etheric psychic realm, who are blocking the rain from coming here. So we'll teach them a lesson for, driving us out of the land. We'll, grasping at straws. But it's interesting that they did have psychic technology that knew how to. Of course, a lot of the Indians had to, like one of the ones down in Arizona, the cliff dwellers, they had to leave because drought, 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 drought. Drought has caused massive migrations throughout history, which has caused massive warfare throughout history. The ever-changing climate patterns of planet Earth. There's no time. There's never been a time when the climate wasn't changing. I mean, the Sahara Desert used to be a very rich, fertile, trees and grass and water and lakes and all that. The Egyptian times, the old ancient Egyptians times, they got, so much lumber and everything from there. But now Sahara is just this barren desert. Desert, the Gobi Desert, used to be lush and green, apparently. Great civilizations, ancient, really ancient times. That's what they say. But certainly the Sahara, yeah. I mean, the Sphinx was made. Who knows how long ago it was made? But obviously, there was. They put it on land with it, which was, it was safe and everything. And then, I think that what there was water that came up in the Sphinx. There's sort of the bunch of water, too much water, so it was excessive rain for a while. That was completely unexpected in the time that it was built, that wasn't the climate. And then, of course, it got buried by the sand. It got completely, almost completely buried by sand, which wasn't there when they built the Sphinx, obviously. So there has been drastic climate change throughout history, pushing massive migrations of people into land that had water. And then, whoops, the land with water is full of people. Well, we need the water, we need the food too. Oh, well, you can't have it, says, well, we're going to take it then. And then that's when the trouble starts. They're talking about, having to relocate people from California and from like Nevada or like Las Vegas, because they could potentially run out of water from Lake Mead, the level of reservoir drops below their, you know, straws the pipes that feed the water to Las Vegas. Trouble in Sin City for sure. So as we sort of are living the apocalypse out here, we're also deciding, you know what? I think it's time to make to have these bubbles arise in waking sleep here. It's time for these bubbles to arise. You know, and ultimately these bubbles may be our ascension, right? Maybe these bubbles enable us to shift dimensions, go to greener pastures. I don't know, but I think we need this time to find out. I don't think you can be without your bubble. I mean, talk about space age. I think it's time for the real space age to happen. This needs to happen right here in California. It's not happening with these aircraft companies. You know, these aircraft companies that used to be all over the place in California, you know what they're doing now? They're building golf clubs. They're building golf clubs. A lot of these engineers went into, you know, the golf club building business, and now they have these like fighter jet golf clubs that look like something you don't even know what it is. They use all that high technology to build these new golf clubs that are supposed to give you 30 more yards, and they don't. But so the space age, you know, the Jetsons, and meet the Jetsons, that's something that we grew up on too. Everyone's going to have the flying cars and, you know, little bubble cars and stuff. Well, maybe it's time for the real space age to happen right now, actually, here in California. Maybe it is time for that space age to then spread throughout the world. Maybe it's time that we do have this little glass bubble, so to speak, over our being here, right, in the waking state. Maybe it's time for the clear light to express itself here in the world. Maybe it's time. Maybe it is the apocalypse. Maybe it is time for the lifting of the veil, which is what apocalypse means. Maybe it's time to lift the veil on multidimensionality, on flawless reality, on clear light, wakefulness, luminous mind. Maybe it's time for that, absolutely. Maybe this is the vanguard of the next trend. Maybe this is what's trending, actually. And of course, those with who have pushed awareness of reality, you know, deeply away, and they're insulating themselves from it by deep sleep, sleep, and wakeful sleep. They'll say, "I don't see that. I don't see any of that. Yeah, I don't. That's not trend. I'm not feeling it. I'm not feeling it." Well, you're gonna feel something coming up soon, and that something you're feeling may not be, you know, too much to your liking. And then, of course, then you're going to blame God. And then some demagogue will come along and exploit your situation by saying, "Yeah, you know, we blame God too. And we found a solution to this. We're going to go somewhere and we're going to have a society culture where you know, we're not going to put up with that God, bad God anymore. And we're going to figure out a way to live without God. And we're going to get what we really want. You know, I'm not going to ask God for what we want. We're going to manufacture what we really want. We're going to figure it all out. We're going to print what we really want. We just all have these 3D printers, and they'll just print anything we want. I'll print a little plastic bobble or something. Not a motorcycle, sure, we'll just print it. So this is, we're in a crazy time right now. So this bubble thing, you know, well, let's see if it happens. Maybe it'll happen. I say, what happened to your personality? No, it's still right here. I just have a little bubble right now that insulates me from it. And actually this helps me be, you know, much, much clearer than before. and not conflicted, and I feel sort of a beautiful sense of continuity through my being, and I'm relaxed and now very much self-assured of the divinity of all. And this little bubble, you know, enables me to stay this way all the time, so I can reassure others. You know, the personality is still right there, just outside the bubble. Well, this is a nice pipe dream. Hopefully it comes true, but the mood of the world doesn't seem to be going in this direction so much. And how much can you just ignore the mood of the world? Hopefully enough. But it does take some trust. It does take some trust, because really, there's not that, you know, that many in the world probably who are ready for that. How do you find those people? How is it help? How are we helping one another? All this. Well, you have to trust the Holy Spirit, you know, with that, really, because there's no way to really explain. It's so seemingly complex here. And the continuity fear, we need to account for that. It's starting to kick up a little bit. I'm starting to get a little nervous about it. It's like, yeah, I don't know if I can do this bubble thing. But I say, hey, you know, I've been working on it for 48 years or so. Or, 46 years. Bubble time. And people say, well, I want to talk to the personality that used to be there. It's still there. You can talk with it. It's just not responding. Just not talking anymore, because I'm the one who's talking now. The one in the bubble's talking. You only have one voice at a time talking through this body. And this is the one that's talking through this body now. And because this one has much greater, superior clarity and insight and advice. So, you know, there's no reason to, just for the sake of good old times and familiarity, there's no reason to go back to have the personality speak through this body, because it doesn't know what it's talking about. It's not going to help anyone, except just what? Reassure people. Oh, good, there's that old lunatic personality speaking again. It makes me so happy. Well, it might make you happy, but it's sure not going to help solve your, you know, problems of believing that there is a problem with reality. Our problem is our belief that there is a problem with reality. Our problem is believing we need to fix this non-existent problem. Problem is that we think we need to accomplish something, attain something, attain a remedy, accomplish a remedy for a problem that doesn't exist. It's never existed and never will. Now, one of the videos I did on that day, Saturday, which was the best day I've ever seen in California. It was like a painting. I said, this can't be real. Someone must be painting this. Must be dreaming. It was like 92 degrees. March, what day was that? March 14th or something like that. March 14th. 92 degrees. Everything felt like summer, warm everywhere, but the smells were different, because it's March vegetation and everything, and yet the heat was there, and the heat wave killed all the poppies down Antelope Poppy Preserve in Lancaster, California. Had a huge poppy bloom going, the heat killed them all. You know, I felt the weeds cooking, you know, in the yard. You just could smell everything is cooking. It's like a barbecue. It's just like a sort of natural barbecue is happening, because everything is tender and fresh and green for late winter, you know, early spring. And then suddenly it's summer heat. And you just like, you experience a day that you never experienced before. I've never experienced a day like this in my life. Where the heat was so strong that you could smell everything. Everything was like cooking. Nature was being barbecued. It was really something. I mean, I couldn't get over it. So I did a video, 4 hours and 44 minutes I did. And it was an awesome video. Best video I've ever done. I went to upload it. I looked at the memory card. Only 3 minutes recorded. The first 3 minutes of 4 hours and 44. So I lost 4 hours and 41 minutes of intense, beautiful, inspired video. And my voice gave out after that. My voice gave out. Maybe it was, I did too long. Spoke too long. Well, that was a day that deserved to be celebrated. I'm telling you, that was something else. Never going to have a day quite like that again, I don't think. The sky was so beautiful. It's just like, you know, summer. Total summer day. Awesome summer day. Like I said, look at everything. You said, this must be a painting. Somebody's painting this. This isn't real. This isn't really happening. Today is more of a normal day. It's warm, but it's normal. It's not exotic. So we're just cooling down a little bit here. A little cool down period, full stop in the wow period here. A little flipping of the script. Just to get us through this very great intensity of this video, because I continue to bring up a perspective which really transitions our landscape, doesn't it? I mean, one moment you have a yard looks like this, the next moment you look out and it's, you know, it's been re-landscaped. You say, wow, I kind of like this new landscape. Then you say, yeah, but I'm used to the old one. Well, which one do I like better? I'm not sure, you know. And we have to stop, full stop in the wow, say, wait a minute, this is the new landscape, so I'm just going to sit here and get used to it. I'm not going to think about the old landscape. I'm not going to compare which one's better. I'm not going to say, well, what's the next one going to be like? I'm just going to say, this is what's here now. Let me simply get used to this landscape. This is called full stop in the wow. Full, very important, very crucial for our success. Keep your mind clear, uncluttered, not struggling. Say, okay, this is the trip I'm on. This is the new landscape. This is what I'm with right now. I'm not used to it yet, but I'm going to get used to it. I'm just going to stay present with the new, you know, new inner landscape. The bubble is emerging. The bubble is emerging from sleep. You know, we're allowing, enabling this bubble to come into waking sleep. So, of course, our perspective is like, wow, this is really something. We're sort of getting the clear light perspective here, bits of it. You know, we're getting clued into it. So our expectations are getting clued into it, and our experiencing, so our familiarity is getting clued into it. So, you know, later on down the road, we say, yeah, of course, this is very normal for me to view things this way. Have this perspective. I'm used to it. I expect it. I'm used to it. I expect it. I'm used to it. Those are the two passengers, expectations and familiarity, that we have no choice but to deal with them. This is like the cross of Jesus, you know, in Calgary. The cross is familiarity, expectations. This is what slows us down. This is the burden that everyone has. This burden. That's why we all have to carry our cross. What died on Calvary, actually? Wasn't it the cross that died? Wasn't it the cross that Jesus had no more use for? He said, resurrection said, I'm through with the cross. I'm finished with the cross, you see. I'm finished with the cross entirely. So it really is the cross that died. Speaking of Jesus, did Jesus really have a mother? Actual mother? No. Does our spirit have a mother? No. We talk about, most people think that Jesus didn't have a father. Well, how did we know that Jesus had a mother, actually? You know, we say, well, the role of the Father, with the Holy Spirit carried that out. Really? Maybe the Holy Spirit carried out the role of both Father and Mother. with Jesus. And since Jesus is a living metaphor for reality, for spirit, spirit doesn't have a mother of that way at all. Spirit is formless. There's only the one creative cause, we call it the Father, to make sure that we don't make the mistake of talking about a mother. There's no mother of God. God doesn't have a mother. And so we're so used to thinking, oh yeah, well, Joseph was, wasn't not the father of Jesus, right? But Mary wasn't the mother either, actually. Okay, but we're very used to thinking of Mary as the mother of Jesus because actually that came in from Egyptian religion. Isis, the cult of Isis, and the sun, was it Horus, something like that, but which was the iconography of that was all over the ancient Roman Empire and Egypt and area. The whole area was full of shrines to Isis, the Egyptian mother with the infant child, okay? And that was already the iconography there. And so people were very used to that. All the people, the pagans on the countryside, this is a fertility goddess, you know, and they were very, very used to it. And so when Christianity became the official religion, they ended up destroying all the old gods, the Roman gods, and the iconographic statues and various, a lot of them. But the Catholic Church allowed one icon to remain, and that was the Isis with the infant. And then they played up this idea of Mary, mother of God, with the infant Jesus. And they just said, just think of it that way. So that became very popular in the church. But it has nothing to do with Christianity, actually. It has nothing to do with it. Jesus was not, he didn't play up his quote-unquote mother. And from the standpoint of spiritual truth, we don't have any mother. Truth doesn't have a mother. God doesn't have a mother. Spirit doesn't have a mother. What's a mother? A mother is something that forms something out of time, space, process, and form. Jesus came here to tell us that time and space, process, and form is a mirage. It's a hallucination. It doesn't exist. If that Jesus, if Jesus is the truth and the way and the life, the word, then he doesn't have a mother or a father, worldly mother or a worldly father at all. He has just one prime creator cause. He called it the Father. Father in heaven, so to speak. So this whole thing of the mother God came from Egypt. Came from Egypt. Mystery religions from Egypt. And that's continued on in the Catholic Church. And has become a very strong force, in the Catholic Church, actually. In many third world countries, the cult of Mary is stronger than Jesus. I mean, I've had situations talking to Catholics from third world countries, other places. They didn't even know who Jesus was, hardly. They couldn't tell you anything about Jesus. It was all about the goddess, all about the goddess, which has to do with birth. And they prayed to her for health, longevity, fertility, relationships, love potions, casting love spells and various spells and all this stuff, which is just ancient paganism entirely. They're pagans entirely, through and through pagans. I really got saved from that. I was very confused and I didn't know how bad it was, really. I was naive. And then this lady who was an actual Christian, from some denomination, some Protestant, I guess some denomination, I'm not sure what, but actual Christian, she told me, she said, hey, these people you're hanging out with, they believe in blood sacrifice. You better watch out. And she says, they don't even know Jesus. They don't even know Jesus at all. They don't worship Jesus. And I said, wow. I said, holy cow. And something triggered, I had some experiences that pointed me out, this foreshadowing of this very bloody stuff. They're very much into sacrifice, and I didn't know it. And so this Christian, might have saved my life, actually, by telling me this. I thanked him very much for that. Because I was trying to find a way to help people, or someone's friend was dying of cancer. I said, we need to make some prayers, and there's happened to be a shrine of the Virgin Mary. And they said, prayers are answered. All sorts of healing has taken place. People have gotten well. If you just go pray to the Virgin Mary, you're going to be, you'll find healing. So I said, well, let me just try it out. I'm desperate. And from there, I got pulled and pulled and pulled into this this cult, really, of you know, worshiping the goddess, the ancient pagan goddess, but in the guise of, you know, they make it seem like it's Mary, the mother of God, Jesus, special place. No, again, Jesus did not give a special place to his mother, and Jesus is not of the flesh. We are not of the flesh. I am not a body. Jesus is not a body. So how could we have a earthly parents and give honor to our earthly parents as if they somehow formed us? We did not. Truth is not formed. What we are is not formed of matter, of time and space, process or form. Is not formed of that at all. What we are is the living light itself that's always been, that was created by God, absolutely perfect and flawless. So, as I said, a lot of religion is very pagan, as a matter of fact. Very pagan. And this whole, the icon of the Madonna with the child is from Egypt mystery religions. Entirely. And just they kept it to make the new converts feel comfortable. They were converted because the Roman Emperor Constantine decreed that all Roman citizens are now Christians. That's how they were converted. So he says, yeah, but don't worry, you get to keep the Madonna and child, and you can keep all, you know, keep worshiping her and asking for favors. And that's when they say, yeah, well, if Jesus won't give you something, then go to the goddess and she'll intervene and make sure you get what you want. As if God, see, it's basically saying, hey, if God doesn't give you what you want, don't worry, the goddess will give you what you want. We got to cover both ways. Of course, this introduces the whole idea of some sort of necessity that God doesn't give us what we want. So we got to make sure we have the goddess on tap here and be on good terms with the goddess and say, hey, goddess, you know, I prayed to God, but he didn't give me what I wanted. So I'm praying to you. I know you'll give me what I want. The goddess says, of course I will. Of course I will. Don't worry. I'll go talk to God and I'll smooth everything out and make sure that you get what you want. But of course, without me, you know, you won't get what you want. So you got to make sure you stay on my good side. And this goes back to our fundamental deception that somehow reality is not giving us what we desire to experience, which is totally untrue. Our experiencing right now is absolutely pure. We don't need some intervening goddess figure to go to God and say, hey, God, something's intervening with what, you know, intervening, and your son is not getting the experiencing they're asking for, but I'm here to, you know, intervene with the intervening. You know, I'm here to iron out those wrinkles. No such situation exists. No such situation exists right now, ever, has ever existed. So we don't need some idle special figure who's, you know, the fixer. You know, we don't need the fixer who fixes our experiencing from the waywardness of God. That's absolutely, you know, you can use any term you want to call it. But let's be very clear, there isn't any need for a fixer at all in terms of